Good morning and welcome to the 2017 Fusion Realtors Community First National Bank Open. This is the Advancers Round. I am Mike Flanagan with InsideBowling.com and we are getting started down here on lanes 5 and 6 this morning. Top 60 bowlers have returned. We had over 180 bowlers yesterday. John Marsala is your leader. And down here on lanes 5 and 6, we have Jason Hansen, Joe Mescher, Andy Mills, and Jason Robarge. Happy you're with us this morning. Fusion Realtors Community First National Bank, great title co-sponsors. Thanks Zach Bajorner and Brandon Steen for all the help that they've done. They bowled the tournament, and they also help line up those sponsorships as they're involved with both of those companies. Five-foot oil pattern in length is very, very demanding and challenging for the players. If you want to see how everyone placed yesterday, head over to InsideBowling.com and you can check that out. Down below in your event information tabs, it'll give you all the scores and all the updates from yesterday. Take you over lanes 13 and 14. Over on lanes 13 and 14, we have Craig Keith, Terry McKinney, Michael Applegate, and Ken Duffield. Getting a few more shots set up this morning for you. Building my picture in picture at this time. I hope you're enjoying the action. I want to thank the folks here at Maple Lanes for hosting this event yet again. This is the 11th of Fusion Realtors Community First National Bank Open. Started back in 2011 inaugural winner was Matt McNeil. Casey Murphy's the only person to win this event twice. Neither bowlers bowled this event this particular time. There were some weather issues in this area. Snow, wind. Bring in two screens at once, lanes 5 and 6 and 13 and 14, so you can enjoy both feature pairs I have for you this morning. Pins do carry over from yesterday. It's a 6-game block this morning. And then we go to a advanced bracket where the 7 through 10 seeds will bowl each other. The winners of each will then advance to go on to bowl the 5 and 6 seeds. Then there'll be one more match to determine who the 5 seed is, and then the top 4 bowlers will be sitting out that whole time, will be your 1 through 4 seeds in the stepladder. So that's how we do it here at the Fusion every year. No surprise there. Hello, everybody. Sorry about that. We're having some issues early this morning, but looks like we're good to go now. Stream health is good. I want to welcome everybody into the broadcast this morning. We are in game number 1 of 6. I will run through the players that we have once again. Here down on lanes 5 and 6, we have Jason Hansen, John Mesher, Andy Mills, and Jason Robarge. And this morning I also have for you over on lanes 13 and 14, I have Craig Keith, Terry McKinney, Michael Applegate, and Ken Duffield. Go back to my split screen so you can watch both pairs at once. They're in the 7th frame of game number 1 of the 6-game advancers round block. Had a long day yesterday, that's for sure. And appreciate everybody being with us yesterday for that long day of action. We had 3 squads, A, B, and C squads. And 180 bowlers. We started at 9 a.m. and we got done close to midnight last night. I had a special match afterwards as well, which was a lot of fun. Standings yesterday after all the bowlers took to the lanes, it was actually 184 to be exact. John Marsala, the lefty from St. Louis, leads the field at plus 213. Jacob Borish, second at plus 206. Third is Pero Duderick at plus 182. Fourth, Brandon Biondo at plus 170. His father, Vince, in fifth at plus 166. In sixth, Dave Barris. He won this event before at plus 162. In sixth, Kenny Calkins, the third, in seventh at plus 149. Eighth, Lenny Borish at plus 140. Ninth, Jacob Bedard at plus 129. And tenth, Shea Bittenbender at plus 123. You can see all those scores over on InsideBowling.com. You click on the link at the top of the page, and down below it'll be down there for your event information tabs. How's everybody doing this morning? Everybody doing well? Hope that you are. We got a big telecast on ESPN today as well, the USBC Masters. Who all is going to be watching the Masters today? I hope they turn it on here in the bowl. I hope I can watch it. I don't know how I'm going to do that yet, but... Or I might just watch it on my Watch ESPN app here up in the booth on my phone. Might be a good way to do that. I'll get a prize fund here in just a little bit. Let you know how much the players are bowling for today. Chris Innes, the format today is they bowl 6 games with the scores carrying over. And when those scores do carry over, we will then cut to the top 10. And the 7th and the 10th qualifiers will bowl each other in a heads-up match. And the 5th and the 6th bowlers will bowl each other. I'm sorry. The 8th and the 9th bowlers will bowl each other in a heads-up match. The winner of each one of those matches, then, the lowest seed left will bowl the 5 seed. And the other bowler that advanced from the round I just explained will then bowl the 6 seed. Those two matches will occur, and then they will then bowl each other, the winners, to figure out who will be the 5 seed of the stepladder finals. Then the top 4 who have qualified, they will be sitting the entire time, and they are now inserted as your 1-4 seeds on the finals. So that's what we do. And I'm going to go down to 13 and 14 and ask the young lady to stop shaking the table so that you don't see the earthquake on there. And while I do that, I'll let you take a look at lanes 5 and 6, and you can check in on the scores there, and I'll be right back. I think we got that worked out now, everybody, so that's good. So a possible 181, 233, 204, and 191 possible down here on 5 and 6. Thirteen and 14, how about a possible 257? Well, not now. 235. 187. 214. 204. Take you back to the split screen. There's Andy Mills. Always wears the colorful outfits. He's kind of like a Guppy Troop a little bit, I guess. Guess you could say that. Do you want to welcome everybody into the chat this morning? Scott S. T33. Chris Ennis. Lars Ulrich. Drew. Janice Wallington says, I've been bowling since I was in my early 20s and love the sport. I'm now in my 60s and I still think of doing any, I can't think of anything I like doing better. Well, that's awesome. I live on the ninth floor overlooking I-35 and Lake Superior. I don't need ESPN to watch cars going by. Anybody watch my challenge match last night? Anybody watch that? Anybody enjoy that? Andy Mills with 212. Yeah, I'll have everything archived from yesterday probably by Wednesday of this week. Dana says, you bet I did watch the match. Another idea for a tournament. Everyone uses house balls. Did you treat yourself to Steak and Shake? No, no Steak and Shakes up here that I knew of. Who won? My lack of sleep kicked my tail and I didn't get to see it. I won the match. I got some Steak and Shake money. Yes, I did. I did, but fell asleep before it was over. Mike was dominant in the first few frames. Hustle to Mike. You threw it great. Yeah, it was a heck of a conversion there on six. There's no doubt about that. Saw it out of the corner of my eyes. I was building a graphic. Flying solo here this morning. I do want to send a shout out to Matt Turek if he's watching. Miss you, Matt, and looking forward to seeing you at a future event. Happy things are going awesome for you, though. Matt's got a lot of cool stuff going on in his life, and he's starting to fly airplanes and all kinds of crazy stuff for fun. Only has so much time away from his job, and I appreciate the time that he spent with us all these years, and going forward, he will be back. Yeah, Chris, there are a few St. Louis bowlers in the field. John Marsala, our leader from St. Charles, Missouri, as a matter of fact. Of course, Shea Bittenbender, Tim Barrett. Pero Duderick. So, action complete on 5 and 6. So just 13 to 14 left on our two featured pairs. Hear it from Maple Lane's great hosts here. They've upgraded the internet. I know we've had some internet problems here this weekend, but our feed is much better here. It's just a matter of the lines. I'll tell you what, they did battle quite a weather storm here, and that can play havoc on internet. So I do want to thank Maple Lane's for being such gracious hosts. The folks here are just fantastic. We're not exactly in a big city here, so they're limited to what they're able to even order or have here. So I want to send a shout out to everyone here at Maple Lanes for, I think I take it for granted sometimes, and I don't mention how great of a place this is and how well they treat me when I come to town. We've been coming up here for 4 years now or so to these events, 4 or 5 years, and it just means a lot to be able to be around good people. I will tell you, I've had a very, very busy schedule the last couple of weeks, and really it's kind of insane of me to even come here with the travel schedule that I've had and the commitments that I have, but I can't say no to come here. So I've been battling a little bit of a cold. I was healthy as could be, and then I went out to the Masters and everybody was sick, and I walked around with a bottle of hand sanitizer the whole week, but still couldn't avoid it. So if you hear a little rasp or a little congestion in my voice, I apologize, everybody. But I'm going to try to get through it as best as I can, as I did yesterday, and really appreciate all the support that I've had in the chat. Yeah, the standings are over on InsideBowling.com. At the top of the screen, you'll see there's a event, or there's a live streaming in progress tab, and then down below there's a blue tab, and you can look and see how everybody placed. What's up, Feeding Frenzy? How are you? Hi, Scott DeBow. Good morning to you. Still waiting for lanes. I don't have anything going on here in front of me. So, I think 5 and 6 are going to get going before anybody else, so we'll just take you down there. I got my wireless camera charging right now, so that's why I'm not bringing it into the booth at this point. I want to make sure that thing's all charged up and ready to go for later today for my downlane camera. So I'm going to let that charge up for a couple games, so you're not going to get to see my smiling face on the screen. I know how much you guys really enjoy that anyway. Ken, thanks a lot. I appreciate you telling me that the streams are always awesome. I sit up in this booth and, I'm no professional by any means. I just sit around and like to talk with you folks. I really enjoy watching these sports talk shows. And until it gets down to, really battle matches for hundreds of dollars, sometimes thousands of dollars on this stream, I kind of just host a talk show. There's really no point when I've got the scores up on the screen for me to really tell you frame by frame what's going on. And really, I don't really see the benefit in that. And there are a lot of people that watch this that just listen to the broadcast. And I update you with the standings and the scores and what's going on and things like that. But it would be absolutely exhausting to try to call what's happening on the screen all day Saturday for like 15 hours and then do it again for another 8 hours on Sunday. It's just, I think I'd be terrible in the finals. I don't think I could do it. I'm not saying I'm great now, but I couldn't do it. There's no way. No way. So game number 2, ready to rock and roll here. I'll tell you who we got. I have no idea what the skip procedure is, by the way, as I was trying to get fired up this morning. How about Kehoe Kuhn? I know I'm saying that wrong. Last name is K-Y-U-N. Kyan? Kehoe Kyan, I really need to figure that out. Jason Price, Matt Schluchter, and Brittany Smith. Thanks, Dump Truck 77. Excuse me. And I'll have for you over on 13 and 14 here. Daniel Healy, Brendan Schrammick, Tom Adcock, and Bradley Krause. I'm actually gonna bring them in now. Got them ready to roll for you. Bring in the split screen here in just a few. Get an opportunity to see how these folks attack the lanes. 13 and 14. I bowled 190 on that pair last night with a house ball. With two holes. Missed two easy spares on the right side of the lane, throwing back up at them. The cut number was 7. Ken Duffield, 7 over. Billy Hibbard just missed at plus 6. If I'd made those two spares last night, I'd have bowled 212? Yeah, 212. That would have put me 84 over. I would have been in, that would have been good for 21st coming into today. House ball last night, my 14 pounder. But I couldn't make spares, so I shot 190. So that would have put me 70 under, which would have been good for 115th place in this event out of 156 bowlers. Yeah, shout out to Bradley Krause for sure. This young man can bowl. I really like Brad's game. Right.
I thought that one might have burnt up, and I was like, it just skated, honestly.
Okay, yeah. Put the little right on the front. If you want to move a little right, keep it
right. Yeah. That one, I was like, all right, that's heavy. Flip side.
I want to welcome in all 170 viewers. There is something that you can do to help us out. There's actually two things you could do. One is you can like this broadcast down below where it says the watching now, or if you're watching on YouTube, there's a little thumbs up button and you can give us a like. The more of those that we get, the higher our channel is rated and ranked on YouTube when people are scrolling through archive footage and or looking for live sporting events. So if you just do us a favor and just hit the like button, it just takes a second. It really does help us out. And I'm not ashamed to ask for that. So with 175 people watching, even if half of you went and hit the like button right now, that would get us close to 90 or so. And I'll go browse in a second and see where we're ranked in the live streams this morning. Tom Adcock, by the way, is just one of my favorite bowlers to watch. So that's great. If you could do that, that would really help us out. And then the second thing that you can do is, if you're not subscribed to our YouTube channel, boy, we sure would appreciate a subscribe. All you got to do is be logged in, and you can just subscribe to our channel. That 10 pin there a second ago, it's pretty cool. I was just watching it here on the replay up here in the booth, but yeah, we really would appreciate a subscribe to our channel. Really helps us out as well. The more subscribers we get, the more we can go out and try to get sponsor money for these bowlers that are competing. Just something small you can do. You can subscribe through the YouTube app, or you can subscribe right through YouTube on a desktop, whatever it may be. But those are the two things you can really, really do to help us out. Then beyond that, if you'd like, you can follow us on all our social platforms. That's always a good thing. Following us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook is where we're located. And it's real easy to find us. Facebook.com/InsideBowling. Also, you can check us out. Instagram.com/InsideBowling. @InsideBowling. And, of course, over on Twitter, the same. Twitter.com/InsideBowling. @InsideBowling is who we are. So really appreciate it. We also just recently redone our website a bit. It's pretty generic. There's more stuff we have to add, but we're getting ready to launch some new merchandise. We have a licensing agreement with Ebonite International. We'll be having some Ebonite International shirts on there, some pop culture t-shirts, and of course our own Inside Bowling logoed shirts. So as soon as that's up and available, we'll be sending people out information about that. Not going to make a whole lot of money off the merch, but it is a little something-something for us to be able to upgrade cameras and be able to afford to go more places and stream more events and do more things. Takes money to put these on. As everybody knows, it's the economics of life. I wish there wasn't money in the ecosystem. I wish it was just more of a everybody kind of just got to do and could take whatever they need, but that's not the way this planet Earth is set up, and everybody has to work for money, and some people make more than others and all that kind of stuff, but for all the time that we dedicate and all the things that we'd really like to be able to do with this channel, we're hoping that selling some merch, people are going to buy t-shirts anyway, and things like that. We'd rather you buy them from us than go to Kohl's or wherever else you shop for your clothes and pick up a shirt here and there, help support the stream, get something back for it, and we should have that up and running here. I would say within about 10 days would be probably when we have that up and running. So we're looking forward to that. I think that's going to be really a lot of fun, and I'm looking forward to seeing people wearing merchandise that we put together. It's going to be really fine quality t-shirts. It's not going to be those ones that'll cut your neck if you just move wrong in them. They'll be very soft, and looking forward to launching that. I mean, I've always kind of wanted to have an e-commerce site, see what we can do. I've got some other big ideas of potentially, once we've got a little bit of a bankroll from this, potentially reaching out to like Parker Brothers and making a Bowlopoly game, around Christmas time. That's something I always wanted to do. I think that would be really cool to have a bowling version of Monopoly. That'd be a lot of fun. So appreciate that. And I'll bring you into the split screen right now.192 watching. We're up to 57 likes. I cannot thank you enough for that. I'm going to go check out our subscription rate right now, see where we're at. We sit at 8182 today. Came into the weekend at 8004, so we've picked up 178 new subscribers to our channel. We just can't thank you enough. We want to be the most followed online bowling channel, not going to lie. We want to be number one. And we're about 42,000 shy of that right now. That is our goal. Numero uno. Yeah, it's Tom Adcock's head was on the scores. That's who you were watching. About halfway through, well, fourth frame of this game number two. Those of you who are ever wondering, Mike, what do you stream with? What do you use to stream? I use a MacBook Pro. And I gotta tell you, this thing is awesome. This thing is just a beast. I was never a Mac guy. I really wasn't. I actually kind of sort of spited them for no reason whatsoever. But I will tell you, ever since I've switched over to Macs, it's about a 2-week learning curve. But once I made the switch, I will really probably never go back. I mean, I can't say that I would never go back, but I do have a desktop actually just being built right now. Shout out to Brian Burkhardt if he's watching. I'm looking forward to getting this regular PC desktop for my triple monitor setup at home. Yeah, I really, really like my MacBook. And this is no paid endorsement by Apple or anything like that, but just allows these streams to really, really run smooth. Now, internet connections and sometimes YouTube and stuff, that gets on my nerves a little bit, but shout out to YouTube. If anybody's watching from YouTube, you know, I wonder if they ever monitor the stream, see what we're doing. I wonder if, like, oh boy, this one here could be a little risky today. Got this maniac in the booth. We should probably monitor his stream today. That'd be interesting. Yeah, good stuff there in the chat about the Monopoly game. You're absolutely right. Instead of going to jail, you go to the Greek church and stuff like that. Absolutely. And putting the showboat in there for Baltic. It could be quite a fun game, and I think a lot of people would like to get it. Strikes aplenty over here on 13 and 14. I'm getting caught up on a little social media here, everybody. We've been gaining more subscribers. Thank you this morning, everybody. Thanks for the subscribes. Yeah, the old showboat being gone. Randy Lombardi says, you are like Harry Carey was with baseball. And I appreciate that, Randy. That was nice of you to say, I guess. I think. I will tell you one of the greatest comments I've ever read, ever, in these chats, is somebody commented on a video one time at the Lucy Bonneau Doubles when I was in the booth by myself. And, you know, obviously there, because there were so many pros, and I knew their games, and I had so much information from being just a bowling junkie of watching the greats of the game on television and everything else, I had a bit of an advantage, and it just rolled off the tongue like it was nobody's business. Just all the people I got to call action on at that particular point in time, and the familiarity with the faces in the field. Somebody actually said... Flanagan channeling his inner Vin Scully. And that was really a compliment there. That was unbelievable. But yes, it's a high fly ball. It could be. And it's caught by the second baseman, Sandberg. Good morning from East Texas. If I missed it, how many advanced to today's matches? Thanks. I'll let you know right now here in the chat. We had 184 bowlers compete. 60 made it to today. 1-3, but they paid, I believe, 62. Old Adzy out there. Adcock has got 2-9 spares, one in the fourth, one in the sixth. The rest are all strikes. Brendan Ceramic up right now. He's got the first six, looking for seven in a row here on the right side of your screen. Bada boom. How about seven in a row over there? He's got the Nebraska shirt on. I guess he goes to Nebraska. I don't know much about the young man, but we're going to continue to watch. Bradley Krause, you can't see him on your screen, but he's on 13 right now. He's having a hard time striking. 9 spare, 8 spare, 9 spare, strike, 9 open, 9 spare, and oh, he gets 10 that time. Good job. and down on 5 and 6. Ah, that's a big old nasty split right there on lane 6. By Matt Schluter, looks like. Jason Price, 105 in the 7th, and that was on an open, so he can only bowl 195. He's on the approach right now. So much lower scores on 5 and 6. 13 and 14 right now. Actually gonna full screen this over here, lanes 13 and 14, as we do have a developing situation here. Working on the first 7 strikes, looking for 8 in a row right now. Brendan Ceramic, oh, 8-10, and look, he gives it a fist pump. This is a tough oil pattern, folks, 45 feet in length. You give it just, you gas it just a little bit, or you miss it a little bit at the bottom, and you could definitely be staring at an 8-10. Just speaks to just how difficult it is. 2-1 ratio, 1-1 in the middles. Adcock with a wrap 10. Let's see if he can pick up this 8-10. Nope, gets count. Take you back to our split screen. Let's see, you guys are telling me that Brendan goes to St. Ambrose University. Well, then why is he wearing a Nebraska shirt? Is he just a big Nebraska fan, or is he from Nebraska, I guess? Isn't that kind of like sacrilegious that you're not supposed to wear like a competing college team bowling shirt if you go to St. Ambrose? Morning, Mike. Saw your Hammer documentary on my favorite bowler, Tom Doherty. Very cool, now that we all know when Tom Doherty's birthday is. Yeah, that's true. Thank you very much for that. You can go check that out over on Hammer's YouTube page. You can subscribe to them, too. I post some content over there with those guys. Danny Val, also another guy who a lot of people don't know about in bowling, but he creates a lot of content for Ebonite International, does a great job, and it's cool to watch the videos and stuff that he produces as well. Over 200 people watching now. We got 68 likes down below. Thanks so much, everybody. How you doing, Jeff Riggles? I tune in. There's an 8-10, and add the 5 to it, and there I am. Yeah. Well, he did have the first 7 though, Jeff. 45 feet in length. This lane pattern, as you know, Jeff, is. If you gas it, like I said, you could leave an 8-10, no question. They're not bowling on Cheetah here, folks. Ooh, and then a run over the rack 7. Hope you're doing well, Jeff. Miss you this weekend. Mike, do you use any particular criteria in determining what lanes you select for camera coverage of the tournament? Yes, I do. I'll tell you how that works. Whenever I go into a bowling center to live stream, I have to work backwards. You would think I would just walk in and be like, oh, where would the booth fit best? Or, oh, where would I like to set up? Oh, where's the internet? That's where I need to have my booth. Nope, wrong. That is not how you set up a live streaming event. You walk up to the tournament director and you say, Mr. Tournament Director, hi. I'd like for you to tell me where the very last match of the tournament's going to be, please. Where's that going to be? Where's your championship pair? Because when it all comes down to it, if we don't have any coverage of that championship pair, we're screwed. So then he usually will say, or she, well, I don't know, Mike. We were thinking about here. Does that work for you? And then we come to an agreement on where the championship pair is going to be. Then I say, okay, well, that's where we know the championship match is going to take place. Now, do you have any other matches that are going to take place prior to that? And let's work all the way to the front of the tournament. And that's usually when they say, well, we're going to have this match here and this match here and this match here, and we need to do this and everything else. And I think, okay, well, how am I best going to cover the last few games of the tournament? How is that? How can I make that the easiest for me? And I need wires ran to those particular areas so that I can be ready for it when that happens without inconveniencing myself or anyone else, having to run wires, put down gaffing tape, all that kind of stuff. So knowing this event here, I know that the championship match is on lanes 9 and 10. So my booth is directly in front of 9 and 10. I know that the semifinal match is on 11 and 12. The match before that's on 13 and 14. The match before that's on 15 and 16. The match before that's on 17 and 18. Then I also know that the elimination matches take place on lanes 3 and 4 and 5 and 6. So that means to the left of my booth, I need cameras and cords ran to be able to cover the lanes 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 for those elimination matches. And then I know that I need enough length and enough cablage to be able to go down to 17 and 18 and then work my way closer to the booth all the way up until the final match, which is 9 and 10, which is right in front of my booth. So that's when I say, okay, well, I need cameras left and right of the booth, so I'm going to go ahead and pick a pair. So I could either do 3 and 4 or 5 and 6, and I like doing 5 and 6 so I don't have to walk as far down if somebody bumps a table or something like that. So that's why we have lanes 5 and 6. And in 13 and 14, same scenario. I need to go two pairs further. I have enough slack for the cables down there, and I'll move those down when need be. But 13 and 14 is not too far of a walk from my booth since I'm behind lanes 9 and 10 if somebody bumps it over there. So that is exactly how we arrive at 5 and 6 and 13 and 14. That's how we do it. And those are the pairs that we stream here. Hopefully that answered questions for you. No, I'm good. I can read it. Joe Engelkiss comes up and delivers me the prize list. I'll go over that with you now. First place in this event was a $150 entry, I believe. I'd have to check that again. It's normally $150. Might be $160. But $2,700 for first, $2,100 for second, $1,600 for third, $1,200 for fourth, $1,000 for fifth. So that's right. If you make it in the top five, you're going to get $1,000 back. Really good payout. Sixth is $850. Seventh is $750. And actually, seventh, there will be a tie because they will be eliminated at the same time. I did like that 810 leave. Then $650 for the next two places, $575, $550, $5.25, $500, $475, and so on and so on. So $29,325 paid out in this event. So really good payout. $146, $220, is that $9? Possible $196. And Adcock. Adcock finishes with, as I'm waiting for the little stop sign guy to get off the screen, please wait, stop. Please wait, stop. Please wait. Okay. Adcock had $236, I apologize. $236 for Adcock. Possible $190 for Bradley Krause. All right, let's see. Yeah, Jeff, you can leave an 810 with anything on anything with 14 pounds. That's true. Although last night I bowled a challenge match here with a 14-pound house ball, and never was I going to leave an 810. Wish I'd been able to be there. Yep, you bet, bud. What's the top score and cut line? I just joined. I'll get you an update here in a second on the scores. Greg Wheeler says, you do awesome work. Thanks for explaining. I figured there was a lot to consider that many probably don't know about. Yep. Good morning, Sue Hess. Ken Roper says, please, please, please share your logic for camera placement with another. I'm not going to go there, but yes, thank you. That's really how you do it. You got to ask them, you got to ask the tournament director, where's everything going to be? And this is where I'm going. It's kind of like, what's that song? I don't know where I'm going. What is it? But I made up my mind. I ain't wasting no more time. Here I go again. I think that's how it goes. Something like that. Here I go again on my own. Travel down the only road I've ever known. Like a drifter, I was born to walk alone. But I've made up my mind. I ain't wasting no more time. I'm going to get the right pairs to stream. Because that's what I do for my chat that I call my team. Bada boom. Write it down. That's right. I'm a poet, and I know it. All right. Game number three is about to take place. I see a little Steve Taylor right there, winner of the Holiday Doubles, one half of the Holiday Double winning team, along with Eddie Flanagan. No relation, by the way. Love throwing that out there. I'm not related to Eddie Flanagan. We spell our names completely different. Although we are becoming best friends. That's right, we are. We're becoming best friends. Talked to Eddie Flanagan more in the last 2 months than I've talked to, I don't know, let's pick somebody. My dad. How about that? All right. Let's go ahead and I'm going to delete this game two shot. Don't need that one anymore. Because, ladies and gentlemen, wave that magic wand in the bottom right-hand corner. Because here we go. That two is going to change to a three in 3, 2, 1. There she is, number three. We're about 33% of the way through this. 33% of the way through this advancers round. Glad you're with us. Want to thank Fusion Realtors, Community First National Bank. Want to thank the Waterloo Convention and Visitors Bureau. Want to thank Ebonite Bowling, makers of the Maverick, Game Breakers. Yeah, I won last night, 190, with two holes. Should have had 212. Yeah, no, I won. Eddie Flanagan, I was just talking about him. He came by the booth just now. Wanted to find out if I won my challenge match last night.
Did everything straightened out yesterday?
What do you mean?
With the internet, or did it still be bad all day?
It got better later in the day.
Good. Just wondering if it has anything to do with people being on their phones.
Nope. It had nothing to do with that whatsoever. Nope. Has to do with this pinging right here. As long as this thing here runs like this,
we're good.
It's when it starts timing out that we got problems. That's strength of internet connection. I'm about to go. Would you do me a favor as you walk down that way? Whoever's on 13 and 14 sitting by that table, it's shaking. Just let them know, don't shake the table.
Yeah.
Turns into an earthquake.
You better hang it in by yourself, all right?
Yeah, I'm doing good. I'm doing good, thanks.
I was saying, yesterday you looked a little tired, but I was like,
I'm still tired,
today.
But yeah, no, I'm good, man.
You look better today, but yeah.
Yeah. All right, Brad, thanks. All right, stopping by the booth, Nate. I was running down to sponsors, I think, before I got interrupted by two people up here in the booth. You know, just, hey, Mike, yeah, let's just talk to you while you're on air. Okay, yeah, sounds great. Anyway, Waterloo Convention and Visitors Bureau, I want to thank them. They've really stepped up and donated a lot of money to this thing for these bowlers. And a lot of bowlers show up here and come into Waterloo, and it's really a good, what would you say? It's a good economy boost when all these bowlers come here? Yeah, I think that's what we would say. And I want to thank the Isle Hotel and Casino, Budweiser, Maple Lanes, Kingpin Bar and Grill. I was talking about Ebonite. I was talking about how they make the Maverick Pearl, and the Game Breakers, Cyclones, Mission Unknown. Check out Ebonite.com. Consider Ebonite your next bowling ball purchase. So I think that runs down to sponsors. And, of course, Joan is family. They do an amazing job. Jennifer's been sending out tweets and everything else. I'll get you updated on the standings here in a second and caught up in the chat. All right, let's go over to insidebowling.com. I'm clicking on the tab right now. Let's see what kind of standings they've got for me. First round scores. C squad, B squad, A squad. Let's see what I got. First round scores, 7 games. That's our combo. Where are my game one scores here? Here we go. I just updated. Round 2, game 1. Here we go. Wow, John Marsala extends his lead after game 1. I know we're in game 3. They'll have game 2 up for us in a minute. John Marsala, plus 276. Jacob Borish, plus 220. Brandon Biondo, plus 215. Vince Biondo, plus 187. Kenny Calkins is in 5th at plus 175. 6th is Pero Duderick at plus 174. Dave Barris is in 7th at plus 173. So, yeah, 173, 174, 175 is 5th through 7th. Crazy. Currently right now, 10th position is plus 145, and that's none other than Lenny Borish. Squeezed in between the folks that I mentioned, also Tony Manna and Shea Bittenbender, also in this cut right now. 22 pins out of the top 10 is Eric Schacht. And so on and so on. You can see this on InsideBowling.com on the event information tab. And I'm going to log into Twitter for the first time today. And I am logged into Twitter, and I see that Nika Upuhar has liked a video on YouTube, and we appreciate that, Nico. Thanks for the share, buddy. Yesterday's poll question was, will Tom Hess win this tournament? Yes or no, basically. Take the field, and about 46% of the people said Tom Hess would win. I mean, he bowled 761 out of the gate yesterday. And just to put that in terms here, 161 over right now would be 8th. And he did that in 3 games. The problem is he went backwards from there. And this morning, Tom is now 98 over in 19th position. How about I tell you who's on this pair? How about Steve Taylor, Coulter Venton, Enzo Hernandez, and Jonathan Shallow? Bring in 2 screens at once. Down on lanes 5 and 6. I have Kurt Kroll, Roger Taylor Jr., Kyle Kroll, and Jay Watts. So I'll leave the split screen on for you. Do these tournaments ever come to the West Coast? This tournament, no. The tournaments that I stream, if that's what you're referring to, I did one event in Las Vegas. And the folks at South Point, Mike Moniak and his crew, they want us to come there and run events. And I want to do it more. Like, I'd love to. But here's the problem. There's not as many bowlers on the West Coast that would be interested in bowling this. So you're already kind of up against the wall. And there's already other large tournaments in Las Vegas that are more amateur-like. Like, there's handicap and all that kind of stuff. And I hate messing with handicap. I mean, I just do. I mean, you're just glutton for punishment there. I don't know how anybody runs a handicap tournament. I would pull my hair out because you're just opening yourself up for controversy. Oh, well, Flanagan needs to re-rate this guy. I'd just be sitting around in a room. I'd be like a fortune teller, re-rating things. I do like handicap in sports games, so maybe I could get into it. But, man, I don't know. That's just something I just don't feel like doing. But so, you know, there's True Amateur Tournament. There's otherwise known as the TAT. There's ABT and all that other kind of stuff out there. And I'd have to attract those people some way, somehow. So I'd have to figure out a way to make them have a chance. And I can't do the same format that's already been done, so I don't know what I would do. I had pretty decent turnout at my event in Las Vegas. But the other problem is our brand was based in the Midwest, and we've got a larger following in the Midwest, and people just don't want to travel over those mountains, and airfare has been pretty expensive the last couple of years. So yes and no. I will say that Neil Lau with BowlersDeals.com and I have become friendly, and he wants to do an event in California bad. He wants us to come be part of it, run the whole thing, make it an inside bowling live stream, and really draw attention to his Bowlers Deals brand. And I think one day we're going to get there, and we're going to work together. I also, the folks at KR Strike Force, they've been wanting to run a tournament too, and they're just such a great group of guys up there. Tony Mendiola, Mike Stout, Brad Handelman, Jason Guest, and the list goes on and on. Of course, all their sales reps as well, who are just fantastic. Brian Beaver, Brian Birch, the rest of the guys, Robert Lawrence. I mean, the list goes on and on. But I might run something in Chicago with those guys near their home office and do something with them. I know it's not West Coast, and I'm kind of all over the place right now, but there are a few things that I've been kind of wanting to do and get involved with certain people. So I don't know if that answers your question or not. I'm always keeping my eyes open. The other thing, though, too, and I'll say this to you guys, I don't want to be this, like, karaoke guy. No offense to karaoke guys all over the world, but I don't want to every weekend be away from home. You know, I just don't want to do this every weekend. I really don't. If I could snap my fingers and just go sit down for a couple hours or something and teleport in or something, I'd be fine with that. But I don't want to do this every weekend. I've kind of made a commitment to myself that I don't want to be on the road more than like 22 weekends a year. So if you look at it that way, I'm pretty much full. I'm pretty full right now. With the events that I do, and I kind of choose what I do. I won't go stream an event unless I like the people or the reasoning behind why they're doing their event. I just won't go do it. So if we're looking at weekends just in general, you know, I did the Bradley, so there's one. Fusion twice a year. IB Open. Holiday doubles. Tournament of the Americas. The Southland Bowling League, NCAA. The Boom doubles I'm doing now. Three, four, five, six, seven. I'm missing a few here. I don't know why I'm drawing a blank on this. No, there's eight. There's eight streams there. I do normally 10 to 12 streams a year. I'd like to get back to helping Billy Eisel with the Proprietor's Cup. I know he's got somebody else that's been doing it, but we've talked quite a bit. I'd like to go back and do that. I'd also like to do the New Mexico Open. It's an event I'd like to be involved with. So, you know, if I stream 12 and then my commitments with Ebonite International and my other clients that I have, if I was on the road for 12 more, weekends. That's 24. That gives me 28 weekends at home and or doing things that I want to do. That's probably a good mix of work and pleasure. Kurt Kroll being inducted into the Iowa State Bowling Hall of Fame in March. Excellent. JG texted me this morning saying that Stout and Steve Cook are best buds. We could do a KR tournament at his center in Northern California, just a thought. See, that's what happens. I talk about this stuff openly on the air, and then shit starts to happen. Next thing you know, we'll have this big tournament in California. So whoever mentioned that in the chat here, who was that? That was Ed Martin. Ed Martin, you might have started something, pal. I will say that I've got a lot of really good connections in bowling, like just good people, you know. Those guys at KR Strike Force, man, they are good peeps. They are good peeps. Really have gotten to know them. Really good people. And they love these live streams. Boy, they eat this up. They want to do one of these so bad. Mike Stout told me, because he and Adcock are good friends, Mike Stout told me that he was listening to Holiday Doubles 2 years ago. He was driving on his way. I don't know. They're road warriors. They're on the road constantly, those guys at KR Strike Force. And he was listening to the broadcast in his car through his Bluetooth speakers. And when I'm calling out action, I'm like, and Liz Johnson leaves a run over the rack 7. He's in his car just cheering. Not because he doesn't like Liz Johnson, but because he has action on Adcock. And it was like the biggest compliment when he told me about this. He was like all into it. Like he was listening to a real radio broadcast. When you hear stuff like that from people, you know, it really makes you want to come out and do this more. It makes you feel like, you know what? Somebody is listening to what I'm doing. Somebody is involved with this. Somebody does care. And I know it's not just him. It's multiple people. I'm gonna full screen this pair again. But that always makes you feel good. And I'll tell you, if you haven't seen this Tom Doherty documentary that I just recently did, I'm really proud of this piece that I did. I think it's a different way of covering a day of bowling. I've had a lot of positive feedback on it. Go watch it. Let me know what you think. You can watch it over on the Hammer YouTube channel. Or on Facebook. You can go over to Facebook, Hammer Bowling. It's probably 6 or 7 posts to go now, but reached about 100,000 people on that post, and just had some really positive feedback. It's 17 minutes in length. Hook it up to your live or to your HDMI cable and watch it at home. Grab some popcorn. You got time to finish some popcorn watching this documentary I did. 17 minutes with Tom Doherty at the Masters. All right, Randy Norton giving us a shout out for Kurt Kroll also. A lot of supporters of Kurt Kroll. Ooh, almost a 7-9 there. Game number 3. This one's over. We're halfway through. Thanks, JG, for the text. You know, the Daytona 500's today. I am like this, like, NASCAR fan, especially this time of the year because there's not a lot of other stuff going on. And, you know, that's one of those races I actually enjoy to listen to the pre-race and everything else. I mean, one of the most memorable sporting days in the history of watching sports, and I love sports, was the day that Dale Sr. died at Daytona, at the Daytona 500. And there's a great, I mean, if you got time for this, whether you like NASCAR or not, you guys really need to check this out. It's on YouTube. Speed Network produced this. It's called The Day. The Day. T-H-E space D-A-Y, The Day. Speed Network. It's the day Dale Earnhardt Sr. died. And it's just, it might be the most incredible series of events that's ever happened to a sport. in one day. There were so many moving parts on that day. And it's just so perfect to call this the day. So that's your homework assignment, everybody. And I've talked about it before on the live stream, but since today is the Daytona 500, it's a great day to talk about it. And it is one of those things I'd love to watch the Daytona 500, but I can't because I'm here. And I love being here, and I love doing this. But, boy, I'd like to watch the Daytona 500 today. But if you don't know about what happened on the day Dale Earnhardt Sr. died, Dale Earnhardt Sr. had just started his own race team. He drove for this guy named Richard Childress all his career. He drove for Richard Childress, and it was one of his best friends, too. Richard Childress was a race car driver and wasn't good enough to keep racing, so he ended up owning a team, and he got Dale to drive for him. I mean, they were hunting buddies and everything else. Just the bestest of friends. And Dale started his own DEI, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, his own race teams, and he set the whole thing up for his son, Dale Jr., so Dale Jr. would have a place to ride. And he got an amazing sponsor for Dale Jr. in Budweiser, which is also a sponsor of this event, by the way. Make it an ice-cold Budweiser. So this all goes down, and Dale Sr.'s got three cars with DEI in the Daytona 500. He's got his good longtime friend Michael Waltrip, who had entered like 300-and-something races and never won a race. But he believed in Michael Waltrip because of the ties with he and Daryl and the whole Waltrip family. So he put Michael Waltrip in a car, the Napa number 15. And his son Dale Jr. is in the number 8 Budweiser car. And his other good friend, Steve Park, is in the number 1 Pennzoil car. And they're all racing for DEI. And these guys get interviewed about this day and about what was going on. And Michael Waltrip goes on to say that Dale before the race said at the end of the race, we're all going to be up here at the front of the field with a few laps to go. And there was a wreck and there was a caution and they red flagged the race. And Michael Waltrip's leading the race and he's sitting on the track and he looks up in his rearview mirror and there they all are. They're all right there in the front of the pack. And he goes, how did Dale know this was going to happen? How did Dale know that we were all going to be up here in the front of this field? And he just couldn't believe it. The other thing that was unique about this day is that it was the very first telecast on Fox. Fox had bought the rights to NASCAR. NASCAR was really booming, and they got the first half of the year. And this is the first time Fox ever covered NASCAR, and they assembled their first booth ever. And it was Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, who used to be Earnhardt's crew chief, and Darrell Waltrip. Darrell Waltrip, one of the most animated NASCAR characters in the history of NASCAR, was just fantastic that day with Larry McReynolds. And they did the whole crank it up segment, and they did the whole, I believe they had like a camera down on the track, actually, the gopher cam or something like that. And it was just really good coverage, and it really was a lot for NASCAR to go to Fox and for Fox to do all that and track the car speeds and all that. And it was just a really big day for everything involved in NASCAR, just a big, big day. And then on that last lap, Dale Sr. doing something he never did was blocking for his DEI cars, for his son, Dale Jr., and for his one of his best friends in life, Michael Waltrip, who had never won a race before. And Michael Waltrip wins the race. Most unbelievable thing. Michael Waltrip wins the race in a DEI car. The happiest day of his life, it should have been. Dale wrecks into the wall. Sterling Marlin kind of spins him out. Not intentional, but it happened. Goes into the wall. Everybody thinks it's a routine wreck. Kenny Schrader gets over there, his other really good friend for life, and it don't look good in the car. Michael Waltrip's in victory lane, has no idea what's going on. Kenny Schrader comes over and says, hey, it don't look good for Dale. Totally turns his world upside down, and 30 minutes later, across all the news networks, Mike Helton from NASCAR gets on and says, we've lost Dale Earnhardt. And what a moment. The whole NASCAR world was just completely blown away. And, you know, there's Dale Earnhardt Jr. losing his dad on the track. He just started this race team. And what's so amazing is what happens the rest of that season is Steve Park goes on to win, I believe, the next week in the number one Pennzoil car. And he makes a reverse lap around the track, victory lap, holding three numbers up. Holding three numbers up, three fingers outside of his car. And the whole NASCAR community was just mourning over this. It was just unreal. And then Kevin Harvick, after sitting out a couple races, Richard Childress and the race team didn't know what to do. They changed the number on the car to 29. And Kevin Harvick, I believe it was his second or third start ever in NASCAR, gets into the now white and red GM Goodrich car and wins. Wins. It was almost like a healing process for the whole team. They win the race. Kevin Harvick wins. Everybody's crying, sobbing. It was just unreal. And then to cap the whole thing off, to really put closure on the whole thing, they go back to Daytona in July. And I'll be damned if Dale Jr. doesn't win that race and has a wonderful embrace with Michael Waltrip in the middle of the grass for that nighttime race in July. Just an emotional season, an emotional thing for NASCAR, and that was the most memorable year in NASCAR for me, and the most memorable Daytona 500 in the history of NASCAR. So I appreciate you guys letting me tell that story. Felt good reliving it, just telling it out loud. And the Daytona 500 is today. The Masters is on today, and the Fusion Realtors Community First National Bank Open is on today. So. If you get a chance, go watch the day. It's really a good documentary on what happened there at that Daytona 500. So back to bowling. If you're not a NASCAR fan and you didn't enjoy that, I'm sorry. But as you know, I get off on tangents sometimes, and I like to talk about other things and other sporting events and things that have happened in life. And that's just a real emotional story there for me. Let's see, getting caught up here in the chat. Thanks for the comments on the Doherty video. I was at Bristol number 3-1, took out Terry Labonte for the win in the last lap. That was August, and he does the following spring, and he dies the following spring. Shout out to my buddy Kyle Kroll. Yep. Sterling Marlin gets a bad rap for Dale's death at Daytona. Yes, that is absolutely right. Mike, did you have to put Tom in a headlock to do the documentary? No, he actually loves it. He's a ham on camera. Jacob Luce letting me know that it was 462 races without a win for Michael Waltrip. Thank you. That's what just made it even more incredible that he won that race. And then, yeah, Scott, the Hans devices came out in NASCAR shortly after that to help protect the drivers even more. And the softer barriers, and they've done a nice job with that. So, yeah, and Scott, you're right. That's when NASCAR started to die. I would say that it thrived there for a little bit with Fox's coverage. But, yeah, you're right. NASCAR certainly hasn't been the same, and they keep doing format changes. So I wish them nothing but the best. I want NASCAR to be around for a long, long time. I'm not like a huge NASCAR guy, but... obviously, you have sentimental ties when certain things happen to you in your life. And my brother and I, very early on, our relationship in life, I used to watch a lot of NASCAR with my brother. Brings back good childhood memories. I was a big Rusty Wallace guy. And awesome Bill from Dawsonville, Bill Elliott. So. And I was wondering if maybe my buddy Sean was listening. He's my new NASCAR guy. And Sean Morris just sending me a note here. Me too, Sean. Me too. Even talking about it. yeah, he said you almost had me in tears telling that story. Yeah, I know. I mean, that is an emotional deal. I seriously, and this is no lie, I am not afraid to cry. And every once in a while, you know, I keep this face on that I'm like this guy that can handle anything. And, you know, I'm nothing bothers me, nothing phases me. But there are times when you need a good cry. I'll just pop on the day. Put it on a big screen, get some popcorn, no distractions, cell phone off. Watch that thing, cry like a baby every time. Every time. Unbelievable. I had an emotional moment like that happen on these airwaves, and I'll talk about it during the next game. Bowling related. Happened in Holiday Doubles about 4 years ago. One of the most incredible things I never saw coming. I never saw it coming. And when it did, it shook me. It really shook me. And I'll talk about it in game number four coming up here as we do finish game number three. I'll take you over to 13 and 14. Full screen it now as 5 and 6 are complete. I'll also take an opportunity to go over and look at the standings here. After game number two, John Marsala leads at plus 272. Jacob Borish is in second at plus 225. Dave Barris now in third at plus 207. Dave Barris has won this tournament before, back in February of 2016. So he is technically the defending champion of this event. Can he win again? We shall see. Brandon Biondo, who just came by the booth, actually. He sits at plus 205 right now. He's in fourth. Kenny Calkins, the third, is in fifth at plus 188. One pin behind at plus 187 is Vince Biondo. That'd be interesting if Brandon and Vince had to bowl each other. I don't know if that's ever happened before. You guys ever bowled each other in a stepladder? No. No, they haven't. It would be, yeah, that's true. It would be like the PBA show today. You got the Tangs bowling each other. We got the Biondos bowling each other here. Well, right, yeah. Yeah, Brandon just said we need more views here than the Tang match on ESPN. You think we could get there, folks? Maybe we could. Boy, wouldn't that be something. Tony Manna's in seventh at plus 163. Eighth is Troy Fuller at plus 144. Ninth, Shea Bittenbender at plus 135. And tenth is Pero Duderick right now at plus 121. Only one pin out is Lenny Borish. And there's a tie at plus 114 in 12th with Brittany Smith and Jay Watts. Tom Hess making a move. Tom Hess is at plus 110 now after two. What'd you bowl the last game? 248, Tom Hess, right up here by the booth. He's got his game face on today. I'm not even seeing a little bit of a smirk or anything out of him right now. He's looking dialed in. He says, Sundays are made for bowling, folks. I love it. Last night, though, I got to tell you, Tom may have spent more time in the booth yesterday than I did. And that was just a lot of fun. That was a lot of fun. Looks like we're getting ready to go into game four here. I'll get my graphic ready to rock. And Tom did get a little smirk there. I got a little smirk out of him. He said, yeah, last night was fun. So. Old Thess. That's what I call him in these events. Thess. T-Hess. Thess. Just Thess. My name is Thess. I'm Casey Kasem. Counting them down. This week's request and dedication goes out to Thess. Dear Casey, I'm a huge Meatloaf fan, and I travel lots of miles going to bowling tournaments. I drive a Tahoe. Would you please play Paradise by the Dashboard Lights by Meatloaf? Thess, here's your request and dedication. Oh boy. I'm glad I'm awake today. That's a good thing. Let's see, I'll get caught up here. Kyle Barrow says, hey, by the way, the 7-9 and the 4-7-10 was picked up during the story. Well, that's good. What I'll do is I'll clip those out and I'll voice them over later. Al chiming in a little while ago, I'll never forget that day. Robert Caratolo, I remember that day. The bump looked innocent, crashing into the wall. Yep. I agree fully. I want NASCAR to be around forever, but they are really driving away the old purist fans with these new format changes. I kind of agree with you. That 500 was the first NASCAR race I ever watched. Yeah, Jacob. I mean, a lot of people watched it for the first time because it was on Fox. It was groundbreaking. Yeah, and Tom Hess is a huge Cubs fan. Welcome in, all 210 viewers. We got 83 likes down below. Really appreciate it, everybody. And there is Lenny Borish. We're going to have Lenny Borish here with Kenny Calkins III, Vince Biondo, and Dave Barris right here front and center, lanes 5 and 6 for you. So I mentioned that there was a very emotional story that happened on Inside Bowling. And this is what happened. It was about 4 years ago now. And my year could be off by one, but... we were at Redbird Lanes in Cahokia, Illinois, all fired up. We had just kind of gotten the Inside Bowling thing going. It was probably our second or third year of running this deal. And, you know, we just have fun. We're just cutting loose. Especially at that tournament. It was just all about the fun. And I'm streaming with Jeff Carter and Lee Bedoris. And Jeff Carter was really a fixture on our broadcast there for many, many years. And I cannot thank him enough for all the time and dedication that he put into this. And just fantastic on the air. I really enjoyed having him in here. But hopefully one day we'll be able to do some more of that together. I know Jeff's kind of taking a little bit of a break from bowling, but really like Jeff Carter a lot. A lot of respect for him. So we're broadcasting, and... it's the night block, which normally the night block, it's pretty exciting, pretty crazy. You know, we're doing interesting things. We're interviewing people. Sometimes people are drinking. We get them in the booth, whatever. And Chad Kloss comes up to me. One of the nicest guys you'll ever meet out here at these tournaments. And he's bowling with his really good friend, Eric Fritton. As a matter of fact, they just both bowled the Masters, and they're inseparable when they're together. They are just the best of buddies. And it's really cool to see these guys hang out together. And they're bowling holiday doubles. I didn't know them all that well. Still don't know them great, but, you know, I admire them, and they have admiration for me as well. And we both know that, a lot of mutual respect for what we do. And Chad comes up to me and pulls me aside and says, "Hey, Mike, can I ask you for a favor?" Micro. And, of course, I'm like, "Yeah, no sweat. Not a problem. What you need? What's going on?" He says... I just want you to know my family's at the hospital with my dad. And he's not going to make it much longer. Probably going to pass away in the next few hours. And he said they're all at the hospital. And we're going to be on the live stream pair. Next game, do you think you could give a shout out to my dad since I'm never going to see him again? And I'm like, whoa. Of course. I mean, like, yeah. My gosh. Yeah. I mean, anything. Absolutely. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but yeah. Of course, Chad. I'd be happy to do that. So here we go. You know, I hop back into the booth, and Lee Bedoris and Jeff Carter are just, you know, in normal mode. They're just, you know, cutting up, and, you know, it's a normal broadcast for us. Everything's going great, you know, and I can't get a word in. I don't even know how I'm going to, like, tell these guys what we're about to do. I don't even know. I can't, like, say, "Hey, guys, we need to go off the air for a second and have a huddle," because I don't want his father or his family to know that this is special. Because it needs to seem as if this is just a normal, we're just normally going to just say this. And I've got quite a responsibility here. So I write down on a piece of paper the news. And Jeff Carter and Lee Bedoris, I'll never forget this. I hand the note to the two of them, and I point at it, and they both stop talking, and then I pick up the broadcast, and they're looking at it, and they go almost like white as a ghost, both of them. Like, they can't believe it. and I can't believe it. And we're about to call the action. So I give them the hand-over-hand signal, which is like, let's just keep this broadcast going type of thing. And they both turn their mics back up, and we just start broadcasting the game. And at whatever point I feel like I could deliver the news or give this shout-out, I finally did it. And I don't know how I made it through it, but I did. And I said, we want to give a shout-out to the folks, I believe it was in Iowa. I believe Chad's from Iowa, I believe, or what, maybe it was Wisconsin. I can't remember that at this point, but it's a mute point. And I said, we want to give a shout-out to Chad Kloss and his family who are watching from the hospital. And Chad wants to give a shout-out to his dad who's watching, always been supporting him bowling. And hopefully they can bowl a good game here and put on a good show for you guys. Thoughts are with you guys. And best of health. And best of the situation you guys have going on there. And we just pulled through it, and we called the game, and we covered them the entire game. And we did it. It was very, very hard knowing the circumstances that was going on. And Chad's father passed away that night, in the middle of the night, and they both made the cut. And they really didn't know what to do, but they thought, you know, Dad would probably want us to bowl. The next morning, Chad pulled me aside, thanked me, and at that point in time, I didn't even know what to say. And they didn't win the tournament. I was pulling for them, but they placed really high in the event. And then here's where it gets really spooky. The following year, the two of them are bowling again, and unexpectedly, that weekend, Eric Fritton, his doubles partner, lost his father. Very next year, same weekend of the tournament. Pretty wild. So to Chad Kloss and Eric Fritton, that's probably the most memorable moment or memorable broadcast I'll ever remember doing, and I don't know if that will ever be topped. And shout out to you two guys for just being good peeps. And it's just one of those things that you just don't ever expect to happen. It really puts things in perspective, and you never know who you talk to, who you can reach, who you can touch through just streaming a bowling tournament. I will bring in the split screen now. Lanes 5 and 6 and 13 and 14. ...223 viewers. Appreciate you guys coming in and watching our broadcast today. 87 likes down below. Appreciate it. And we're up to 8188 in subscribers. We're only 12 subscribers away from 8200 on our YouTube channel. It's very easy to subscribe. It helps us out. So if you're not subscribed to our YouTube channel, please go out and do so. Inside Bowling on YouTube. You'll be notified when we're live again in the future. It's one of the small things you can do out there to help us out. Should have standings up after game number 3 here shortly. I'll keep an eye on that. Really am battling this head cold. I really hope I don't sound too terrible here today. This is what we call the advancers round. I really don't know what else to call it. Cashers round, round two, Sunday morning. One of my favorite songs of all time, too, by the way. Easy Like Sunday Morning. It's kind of dating myself, showing that I'm a little bit older than I really am, but You guys you talking about the match?
Sorry?
Yeah, my match?
Yes, I love the
oh, yeah. Yeah, isn't it funny? Yeah, oh yeah. Fine. One game. That's funny. The guys were down there talking about my two-fingered match last night with the 14-pound house ball against Brian Bowers. That was actually really funny. What's up?
Sit in for a minute?
Yeah, absolutely.
Give you some inside info on the house and everything?
Yeah, sure. What's up, Nate?
Not much. How are we?
Good, man. Nate's going to join me for a little bit. Nate, tell everybody at home a little bit about you and this event. And, I mean, every time I've come up here, you've been here.
Yeah, so I work in the pro shop here on the weekends. Get to know a couple of the guys here with Shay and Tim and Jake Gins.
Yeah.
So they come up, stay at my parents' house. We have a good weekend, have a good time. So, talking to a lot of guys. They basically said it was like three different houses this weekend. I'm not sure how much you've talked
about
that this weekend.
Yeah, I've been getting that too.
Yeah, so Shay just made the flip here. And we moved a whole arrow from, we just came off 2930.
Yeah, they're slicker down there, yeah. And then you come down here to the low end, and then you just, you move.
Yeah, it's just an instant move, and you just, you don't even think about it. You just move and trust it that it's going to hook. So,
yeah, we've got game standings update after game number 3. You can go check it out. Updated 2 minutes ago. John Marsala leads at plus 315. Big lead over Jacob Boris at plus 237. Dave Barris at plus 229 is third. Vince Biondo is now in fourth at plus 225. And his son Brandon is in fifth at plus 218. 30 pins back and sixth is Lenny Borish. You see him, he's actually on the pair there, 5 and 6. Kenny Calkins, the third, is at plus 187, one pin behind Borish. Tom Hess is up to eighth at plus 158. Ninth is Jay Watts at plus 148, and 10th is Tony Manna at plus 145. Troy Fuller on the outside, 14 pins behind in 11th. You can go check that out. Your buddy Shea is in 15th at plus 122. He was in the number. And he's going to need a couple of games here coming down the stretch.
Yeah, he had a tough pair there. Couple bad carry, and I missed a single pin, which never helps the cause. So. It should be interesting with the leaders making the flip here with the later games here. If they can make the adjustments a little quicker than the rest of the field here. So,
yeah, we're here at Maple Lanes in Waterloo, Iowa. Mike Flanagan, joined by my buddy Nate here in the booth. And we got 213 watching now. We got 96 likes down below, just 4 more to go to get to 100. We got people subscribing to the YouTube channel today. We're up to 8193, just 7 away from 8200 subscribers. So we certainly appreciate that. One thing about coming here is everybody treats us so good when we come into town and set up our stream. And Maple Lanes has really transformed over the last 5 years or so. They got these really cool AMF masking units that they've completely redone. They're retro, but they're redone. They look cool. They've got the new scoring monitors here compared to what they used to have here. And they've done a really nice job upgrading the bowling center.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. The owners of Maple Lanes are in the process of buying the other local center here, so.
Or are they really?
Yes.
Is that Cadillac?
Cadillac Lanes, yes. They're in the process of purchasing that, and hopefully make some improvements to that and add some tournaments there and improve the bowling community here in Waterloo.
Who's this over here that has the first 6 on 12? Who is
that gentleman, Matt.
Who's he bowling with?
Right here, Matt, this guy.
Well, Matt Thompson.
Yep.
Yeah, Dave Dentlinger was talking to me a little bit. He made a deep run in this event. I think it was the last time or maybe the one before.
September, I believe.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. And he was talking about my two-fingered house ball match last night. Did you get a chance to catch that?
I did not catch it. I heard about it.
Yeah? What'd you hear?
Well, I had heard, who was in the booth with you? It was Hess and...
Brian Bowers.
Brian Bowers.
Yeah.
So I had heard that they challenged you to this match, but I didn't hear the outcome.
Well, what happened was really, I'm trying to get subscribers for my YouTube channel. Like, I'm really big into this now because I really think if I ever get the subscribers up to a really large number, that I really could attract sponsorship dollars. More and more companies are spending money on like live streams and stuff on YouTube other than like the Super Bowl.
Absolutely.
So if I ever got to like, you know, 100,000, 200,000 subscribers, I think I could actually sell $15,000, $20,000 sponsorships, you know?
Absolutely. That makes total sense.
I really believe that. And that would be amazing if I could do that. So I want to have an event like that where I'm paying $20,000 for first and we're streaming this thing, you know, and I got representatives from a company here and, you know, it's just cool all the way around. So anyway, so that's kind of like a goal, and you got to start somewhere. So I'm trying to pump the subscribers.
Makes total sense.
So basically what I did is we were at like, I don't know, like 80, 70 in subscribers. And I was like, all right, let's see if I can motivate some people to subscribe. And I was like, if we get to 8,100, I will bowl a match after the last game today with a house ball for $20 against the guy in the booth if he would accept, and Brian accepted.
Okay.
And then I said for every dollar over, or for every subscriber over 8,100, we would add a dollar to our bet. And it worked. We got like 100 subscribers by doing this. So we got to, the bet was for $77.
Okay.
And I bowled him. And I had two holes, two makeable spares that I missed, and I bowled 190.
That's pretty good with the house ball on this.
Yeah.
I'm left over of this.
Oh, yeah. 45 feet in length, 14-pound house ball. And, you know, I really wanted to make those two spares, though, because if I make those spares, I shoot 212.
Right.
And then, you know, I'm 84 over for the tournament if you times that by 7, which would have, I'd be in the stepladder.
Yeah, easy. In soft.
So I was a little disappointed missing those spares. I really was. But I was happy to win the match.
What did Brian shoot?
Like 164.
Oh. With the house, ball.
Yeah. He doubled in the match and put a little pressure halfway through. He took a slight lead change. There was a lead change like in like frame 6, but I doubled in the 8th and the 9th. I pretty much figured out the right lane 14, and 13 was hooking more.
Yeah.
Quite a bit in the heads. So I had to loft the ball an extra 3 feet or so, and I made that adjustment in the 9th. And just pured it.
Beautiful.
And I walked it out. I was very, very cocky in the match.
That's
you know, I
all
was
right.
trying to put
As
on a show.
Be.
I was trying to put on a show for the fans.
That's what time does the show start today? 12:30?
I'm not sure what time it starts, but
I didn't even see who's on. Do you know who's on the show?
Oh, I know who's on the show. Okay. Yeah. Jason Belmonte is your top seed.
Okay.
Alex Hoskins, amateur player, works at Storm in Utah.
Okay.
Really good resume at the Open Championships.
Oh, does he?
Yeah, he's really solid there. He's your two seed. He lost to Belmo in that final
kind of
match
the
of the
off,
winners
yeah.
winners bracket.
Okay.
And then your three seed is Darren Tang.
Okay. Yeah, Michael Tang's brother, right?
Yeah, Michael Tang's the four seed.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh
so
yeah.
We might have some brother action.
Oh yeah.
So we got some father son action
here. Yep.
And we might have some brother action on the show.
Absolutely. It's a family affair today.
I like it.
I think there's a song that goes, "It's a family affair."
We might have to lead that in when they're throwing their warm-up shots later today.
No kidding. And then the fifth seed is Martin Larson, who's been making like every show and still doesn't have a title on American soil.
He throws it so good. I love the way he throws it. It's just he just hasn't had the success on TV.
He's a good dude. I'll tell you what. I have a feeling when he does win, he's gonna like run a stepladder because that's about the only way it's gonna happen.
Yep. I agree.
You know, because he's just going to break through. And then when he does, he's probably going to win like 10.
Oh, exactly.
He'll be a Hall of Famer within a year.
It's like I help out with the youth league around here. And it seems like every time that we have a younger gentleman or woman shoot 700, it seems like they have a couple immediately after that, their first one. So I feel like it's the same situation where once he gets the first one, yeah, you're right. He's going to have, you know, 5 to 10 real quick.
Now, are you bowling much anymore?
I bowl a little bit here. I live in Cedar Rapids, which is about 45 minutes away. I drive up and bowl with my family on Thursday nights here in league. I sub a little bit here and there. I try to bowl as many tournaments as I can. I just after college, I kind of got a little burnout, so I don't practice as much as I used to, so I'm not as sharp. So
completely understand.
It's tough to lace them up against the competitors we have here today. So. Ooh, Hess here chirping a four pin right in front of us here.
Got some little bonus coverage for you here. Coming up. Matt Tomsu has the first eight. And we're going to go there now on my wireless cam. There is Dave Dentlinger, by the way. Brett Cooper is going to come into your screen here in just a moment. But this is Matt Tomsu up on lane 12 right now. He's got the first eight, looking for nine in a row. And that's usually what happens when I put a camera on him.
You had that black cloud feature? Or?
Oh, yeah. It's a nice run over there.
That's probably we need to add some special effects with a black cloud and some rain or something. Uh-oh.
What's Hess saying down there?
Yeah, he was talking about the black cloud.
Oh, we'll black cloud him. I don't have a problem with doing that.
Usually when we put the camera on him, he doesn't strike. All right. Do we know who's bowling with Hess? Who's the one here?
Tony Manna and Tom Hess.
Okay.
On the left lane.
All right. So.
Yeah, and then Brandon Brooks and Josh Luce.
Okay. So Brandon and Josh are struggling here, but looks like Tom and Tony have it figured out.
All right. Let's see how much I can cloud Tom.
All right.
Some more bonus coverage here. Here is Tom Hess, right here in front of the booth on lane number nine. Tom has spare, triple, eight spare, nine spare, strike, looking for a double. And yeah, pretty much. He's probably gonna look over here now.
As on cue, uh-oh.
Yep, he is not happy about that shot. Not happy. So as Jeff Riggle says here in the booth, in our chat, we'll take it back down to Lenny Borish. Weather warning graphic needed. Yeah, pretty much.
Ooh, Lenny blowing out the 10 there on the 5. What's he got left? Lenny's got 230 left there on 5 and 6. After a big game last game. 260 last game, I believe. So Lenny's trying to make a run here.
Yeah, we might have a standings update now, too. Let's see. Nope. We got the game 3-1. No, we're still in game 4. Yep. So jumping the gun there a little bit.
Okay. No, but Lenny moved up to – where did Lenny move up to?
Lenny is now in 6th. Okay, yeah. Plus 188. Okay. He's 30 out of 5th.
Okay. So, yeah. I think with the big game of 260, I think he moved up 5 or 6 spots. That's
yep.
good. All right. That's the thing is, I think even a 240, I think, moves you up a ton today.
Yeah, absolutely. Vince Biondo.
Did we only have one woman make the cut today? Just Brittany? Or is there
I think so.
Okay. I mean, she hooks it more than me, so I mean, she throws it really good. So. How many colorful pants did we see yesterday?
Just a few. And Andy Mills, of course.
Yeah. I only see one today, right? This
yep.
is the bright orange?
Yep, that's Andy. All right.
And then you got Ken Duffield with his holes in his jeans, per usual.
Yep. Yeah, Tony Manna is bowling good right now.
Yeah. Yeah, he's throwing it good all day.
He's in 10th right now, plus 145, and he's here in front of our booth. He's got 247 left. Don Breeden can bowl 217.
Ooh, blowing the 5-7 out.
And Breeden right now.
I don't think he got off to the greatest of starts. So.
No, he didn't. Wow, he's all the way down to 30th at plus 71.
Yeah, so I was following Shea this morning, and obviously, and then Breeden was trying to play the gutter early with a 1,000 grit timeless. And then finally moved in a little bit with the rest of the pair. And has more success recently than he did earlier.
We have a request for you to identify yourself in the booth.
Me? Oh, I'm Nathan Johnson. a graduate of Lindenwood University in 2011. Got the pleasure of bowling with a lot of fine competitors.
And you're an Iowidian.
Yes, I am. I'm from here. I'm originally from Waterloo, Iowa. Bowled a little bit here and there. Work at Franz Pro Shop here in inside of Maple Lanes. Been working there since I was 14, so I've been there for 14-ish years, 15 years. On and off, took a little break. Obviously, once I went to school, I couldn't work as much. But, you'll see me here on the weekends when we have special tournaments like this. I help out a little bit, so.
And Nate's been real cool and always helpful checking in on the booth every time I come up here. So you're welcome in the booth anytime, by the
fantastic.
Way. I don't necessarily invite people anymore.
No,
it's
okay.
Just an open door policy. Just come sit down.
Fantastic. Yeah, I felt bad. I should have probably sat down yesterday a little bit, but I felt bad. You were here by yourself all weekend. So.
Yeah. I know you guys are sponsored by Ebonite, but about how many people do you see throw the timeless this weekend?
That's a good.
I got to tell you, I haven't paid attention too much ball choice.
I haven't seen a lot of timelesses just because of how long the pattern is. I've seen a lot of surface, which besides Don, you know, sanding up his timeless, I haven't seen many go down the lane. But Hess had great success with his Mako yesterday early. Right?
Yeah, 761 with the Mako.
Yeah, that pent-up Mako. So it's like, it's one of those things. I think you need something rolly more than, you know, kind of that extra shape on the back end that the timeless created. I haven't really seen like one ball dominate the weekend, have you?
No. And I don't think you really see that much in bowling anymore
true.
At all.
That's true.
There's too many.
There is. There's way too many options. There's way too many styles, you know, so everybody's trying to create their own shape, you know, down lane.
Pretty good game here. 245 max score. And 269.
So it's Kurt Kroll on the left, and that's a college player. I forget his name.
Kyle Kroll?
Kurt Kroll is on the left.
I think that's Kyle Kroll is letter D.
Kroll, okay. Yeah, so we
Kroll.
Have Kroll and
Kroll.
Kroll bowling together.
Yeah,
okay.
So if we said that really fast, you wouldn't know. Kroll? Kroll.
Kroll, okay.
It's, yeah, and with my head cold, it comes out kind of the same.
did we only have one two-hander make it? I didn't even see how many were bowling yesterday, but is Eddie Flanagan the only two-hander today?
Could be. It's probably a pretty good observation there. I don't know how many we had enter the tournament.
That's not a good break for Tom Hess.
Hess is going to be pretty fried.
Yeah.
He was 4-6.
So he's got 201 if he gets one on the split. Josh can't shake out the 7 or the 10 on his second shot there.
You could scoot over this way, just a flicker.
Yeah.
Got this chair in the way, but.
No, it's all right. I'll just move over. Right,
I'm just bringing it into the booth. Might as well say hi to everybody. Hi. I finally got
good
this camera set
absolutely.
Up.
Absolutely.
So. They say you have a great radio voice here.
Oh, right? Fantastic.
Bowling voice.
Oh,
that's
thank
a
you.
Good bowling voice.
Yeah. My day job is just actually punch a calculator all day. So
oh, really? It's
yeah.
Like a Texas Instrument?
Yeah. So, but yeah. So glad to be here. So
it's warmer in here today, but I'm still wearing the comfy.
No, it's a little warmer in here today.
I do have my logo Infusion jersey on here.
There
though.
You go.
Got the old logo though.
That's all right. Well, you haven't had a chance to get the new
no,
one.
No,
right?
I haven't been
that
able to update it.
That just got launched a couple weeks ago, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Sure did.
So yeah, we got. The new site, the new merchandise, and everything.
Yeah, merchandise is coming. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. She's so. Coming around the mountain when
yeah.
she comes.
That's
take
right.
back out to the lanes here. Well, we're gonna have Hess in the next game on 13 Ooh. And 14. He's gonna need a game.
Yeah, after that.
Going into game five.
On 70, yeah.
All right, who do we have down here on 5 and 6?
I think that'll be the end of the
is that Duffield again?
Yeah, that's Duffield, yeah.
We had them in the first game.
Oh, already?
Yeah, I
guess. Well, on the same pair?
Well, we had them on that pair over there.
Oh, on 13 and 14, okay.
Yeah, so let's see where these guys are. Yeah, so it looks like Craig Keith, Terry McKinney, Michael Applegate, Ken Duffield.
Okay. So we should have the leaders, Marcel and Borish, the last game? Is that one of them?
Yep.
Anticipated?
Yep. Okay. That's what they say.
Okay.
So I'm going to bounce out of there and take you over to 13 and 14, where we have the group that was just in front of us on 9 and 10. And that's Tony Manna, Tom Hess,
Brandon Brooks,
yep.
and
Josh Luce.
Yep, that's right.
So this will be a fun pair to watch.
Absolutely. Especially Tony. Tony's been going good here the last couple of games, trying to make a run here. So
We have 103 likes on our webcast. We have 225 people watching. And I was just noticing our Inside Bowling YouTube subscriber growth
there.
Today has been outstanding. We thank you for subscribing. As we are at 8198. We are just two subscriptions away from 8,200. So that's pretty cool for us. We're trying to grow that as much as possible.
Do we know who's making the deepest run today? Did we follow that at all today?
I haven't been doing too much analyzation of
okay.
that. I was just trying to get the live. We had some live streaming issues already again this morning, but it was
good.
A YouTube issue.
Okay.
So I was really workshopping that. And
okay.
I don't have my statistician here.
Oh.
See this right here?
Yep.
That's bad.
Not good.
When that happens.
Yeah, we don't need any of that.
Yeah.
Hopefully it runs smoothly the rest of the day. Oh.
Well, we're one subscriber
close.
Away from 8,200.
We got a little help from somebody.
8,200.
Thank you out there for
subscribing.
Latest subscription.
Yeah, and you see the little curve goes up right here.
I like it. It's great.
Probably do one of these.
So we have a chance for two father-son combos later, right? Is that what I'm seeing?
Yeah, Lenny Borish and Jacob Borish and Biondo and Biondo.
Yes. Okay.
That yeah, it would definitely be a family affair today. Absolutely. With the PBA and this.
Yeah.
Jason Lancer. We have a request for Jason Lancer. He's bowling with Galbraith, who had 300 yesterday, Tommy Barnwell, and Mark Stinger.
He shot 300 the last game to get in, right?
Yeah.
He was minus 77 with one to go and shot 300 the last
yes,
game
he
to
did.
Get to plus 23.
Thanks, Silver Silent Dirty. We just rolled 8,200 subscribers. That's awesome.
Well done.
It'd be nice when we get to 82,000. Just yeah. Think, you'll be like, oh, I was the first 10%. They actually, YouTube sends you a bronze Google Play button.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they send it to you in a plaque congratulating you on 100,000 subscribers.
Oh.
Yeah.
We got to get on that.
I know, man. 92,000 to go. Well, 91,800 to go.
Well, the good news is you're in Little Rock here in a couple weeks, right? So we go a little south and we get a little bit of extra spread the love, right? So.
Yeah. Wow, now we're at 8,202. You guys are just.
Yeah. Oh, Shea blowing out the 10 there for a double. Start here game five. He's going to need a big one here. So.
He is.
Giving me the iron fist, so let's see what happens here. Marsala still striking. Man. Just put a fresh 2,000 on his bowling ball this morning, so he requested a little bit of surface. A little inside information there.
But, got a question here in the chat. It says, why did Tom Hess leave Storm? Seems like he was bowling well with their equipment a few years back. I'll try to answer this for you. Brunswick was willing to give him a salary and to represent their pro staff on international events and demos and seminars and things like that. And he tried their equipment and he thought it was good. Storm had a pretty full staff at the time. And sometimes guys would like to be a little more involved with stuff that's going on. And I think that's why he left. And then he left Brunswick for change of pace, and now he's with EBI. So, you know, that happens sometimes with guys. And let's see if I've got that shot again for you. Let's take a look at Hess one more time. Looks like he made a ball change. And 10 back.
Is that the Tyrant Pearl? No.
Is it a Game Breaker 2 Phenom Pearl?
Could be.
That's my guess.
Okay.
Guys do leave bowling ball brands from time to time. I will say this. I will say that I believe many of the manufacturers are making really good equipment these days. And most brands have a top to bottom lineup of balls that give you enough variety. And I think, just a personal pet peeve, I think there's way too much emphasis on the balls.
It is. It definitely,
than the bowler.
It seems nowadays where guys are so reliant on the right ball at the right time rather than just focusing on making the correct shot.
Yeah, and I'm not going to sit here in the booth, okay, and tell you that you have to throw an Ebonite International product, okay? And this is why I'm not going to tell you that, all right? Because you're going to make a choice based off of your opinions on what you want to do. And I'm not going to try to do a sell job for you. What I will tell you about Ebonite International is that Ebonite International, since I've been aligned with them and I helped them, have treated me better than any other corporation in the history of my entire career since I started working at age 16. They treat me and respect me and work with me and laugh with me when we work together. And our collaborations together, it's the best work environment ever for me personally. They support every live stream that I do. They are part of the reason why I am able to go on air because of them, it is possible that you can watch this broadcast. Okay? So I would appreciate if you, when making a bowling ball purchase decision, if you would seriously take a heavy look and a hard look at Ebonite International.
Absolutely.
They have so many bowling balls across the four brands that there's going to be something that you can have success with.
Absolutely.
And multiple products that you can have success with. But I'm not going to sit here and tell you that you have to throw an Ebonite International product. If you believe in what Ebonite International is doing for Mike Flanagan inside bowling and bowling as a whole and as a sport, and you believe that's what you choose and you want to throw, then that's great. And I'm happy for that. I want you to do that because the more successful they are, the more they're going to keep supporting what I'm doing.
Exactly.
Okay? So that's my little soapbox for a minute.
No, exactly. But
that's the way I look at it.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff coming out, good stuff coming out of Kentucky right now. Yeah. I mean, the Tyrant and the Tyrant Pearl are fantastic. The Mako seems to be rolling really, really well.
Yeah, you know, Dom Barrett, perfect example. You know, that dude, he drills bowling balls, throws them in the practice session, says, I like the way this one shapes off in the end of that pattern, and then he will drill three or four of them, tweak them different ways, and then he uses pretty much that ball most of the tournament and drills a few of them, and then ball progresses up and down based off of that ball and that shot shape. And he's had success. He hasn't won yet.
I don't know how. He throws it good.
He hasn't won yet with Ebonite International products, but he's made some shows.
It's kind of a similar situation to Martin Lawrence. Right, or Larson, no. We were talking Larson earlier, right?
Yeah.
Martin Larson, yeah. Same situation. They both from Europe, you know, had decent success over there and came over here and just haven't quite got the job done. So. Give a shout out to Clayton. He's one of our younger bowlers. He's just getting into it. I think we're gonna drill him a 10-pound ball here. We're just trying to figure out what we're gonna drill
cool.
him here. So yeah,
I'm gonna bring in the other pair now too. We'll go to the split screen. I will also say, speaking to the bowling ball manufacturers, that if I'm being supported and this event is help being funded. And supported the GIBA and all that with Ebonite products, I'm not going to go out of my way to do a promotional piece for another brand out there. That just wouldn't be right.
Right.
But I'm also not going to shy away from if somebody asks a question, what's so-and-so throwing? It's not like it's forbidden to say another brand on the airwaves, because that wouldn't be doing the viewers at home justice of being able to bring you a bowling event.
Right.
You report it the way it is.
Yeah, Rob Gacho's helped out with this event a lot, especially with the entire GIBA tour, you know, being able to kick in a ball or a bag here and there. It's been phenomenal for
and
just the entire event.
Yeah, and Sean Morris is the sales rep in this area. And because I come to the event, you know, he's got a lot of things he's got to do. He's got a lot of events he's got to work and whatnot. So they kind of let me handle it here. But Sean was watching this morning and texting me and everything else, and you know, I know Sean would like to get out here and bowl
Absolutely.
The event one of these times. So,
yeah, it's always a good time when Sean is in the area and we can hang out and, you know, talk bowling and how things are going from, you know, other pro shops and how things are, what balls are selling in certain areas. It's great to get that feedback.
Mike and Nate here with you. 2017 Fusion Realtors Community First National Bank Open here from Waterloo, Iowa at Maple Lanes. This is game five of six, and coming up after this, we'll have our modified stepladder that we do every year. It'll be the 10 seed against the 7 seed, down, I believe, on like 3 and 4, and then the 8 and the 9 seed will bowl each other on lanes 5 and 6, and then what will happen is the winners of each match will then flip to the other pair that we just used, and the lowest seed will take on the highest, or we'll take on the 5 seed, and the highest seed left will take on the 6 seed, and that will happen down there. And then the winners of each one of those matches will then move down, I believe, to 17 and 18, and they will bowl a match Then the winner of that match on 15 and 16 will bowl the 4 seed. The winner of that match will bowl the 3 seed on 13 and 14. The winner of that match will bowl the 2 seed on 11 and 12. And the winner of that match will bowl the tournament leader, who should be John Marsala, on lanes 9 and 10. And that will be the rest of our coverage for the day.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. I know it's a long way of court, but I would, especially the way it's been with the three different sections, if we could ever get a camera on the high end and just see the difference of way, like how much different they have to play them down there than down here.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know it's just a ton of cable and a ton of tape and stuff, but. Yeah, it just amazes me when I walk down the center. How much differently they are playing down here on the low end than the high end.
Didn't they have the lanes leveled here?
Yes, they did. They brought in a kegel person 3 years ago.
Lane map or whatever they call it.
Yeah, lane map. And like every lane was leveled and everything, and like topography should be the same across the house. But it just baffles me how much different 1 through 8, even 9 and 10 is kind of getting there. How much more they hook. Like, it is legit probably a 3 and 2, if not a 5 and 3 move left for a right-hander. Just immediately before you even, like, as you're walking down, you already know you're going to make that move.
Yeah, we have standings after game number 4. John Marsala in the lead at plus 330. Second is Jacob Borish at plus 252. Third is Vince Biondo at plus 236. Brandon Biondo in fourth at plus 219. Then Dave Barris, defending champion of the February event, in fifth at plus 197. Sixth is Lenny Borish at plus 184. Seventh, Tony Manna at plus 180. Matt Tomsu in eighth at plus 176 after that huge game he just had. Ninth is Shannon Buchan. Boy, Shannon's hanging around. This is his home house. Yeah. Plus 173. And in 10th now, Mike Peters out of nowhere, plus 161. Hess is 11th, two pins back.
That's probably our highest climber that we were talking about here a little bit ago. It's probably Mike Peters.
Yeah, you're probably right.
Hess is struggling this game as well.
Yeah,
he
is.
With a spare, he will have 70-ish in the fifth.
Personal opinion on the Mako and the Tyrant, what's the differences? Well, the Mako is going to give you more down lane reaction. It's going to be a cleaner through the front. The Tyrant's going to want to dig in early. It's going to want to hook in the mid lane. And if you're not blowing on enough oil, it's not going to do a whole lot for you down lane. But if you have a lot of oil and you need something to dig in and start making a move, that's going to hook more than the Mako overall for you. Yeah, Hess missing the 2-8 there.
Yeah,
that's a mental breakdown.
That's not helping the cause by any means. He's got what, max 210 left, or yeah, he's got max 210 left on a pair that he struck once. It'll be interesting to see what happens here after he needs a big game. Yeah, he just fell out of the number. So.
Wow, look at you. Nice. Oh, good. Where am I? Oh, Gallica. The old days are back, huh? Mm.
So Mike Peters just made the flip here. What has he got going here? He's got 240 off the sheet. Right? So he just got to 10th, right?
Yep.
Okay. Stepping up in the 10th right now. Let's see what we got here. Strikes in the first one. Peter's trying to make a great run here on this short six-game sprint here this morning.
All right, let's see what Hess does.
That was a good shot there. Great shot.
Sure was.
Ooh. Still not happy, but that was a good shot there. Mike Peters with the double in the 10th there, so he's going to shoot 240.
Yeah, so that's going to put him, Mike Peters was 10th, so 240 is going to put him, 240 what?
246 if, with a strike here.
All right, so that'll move him to 207 over.
A little right, so he's going to shoot 243.
Yep, seven okay. There, so that might get him inside the top five. Where's Dave Barris?
Right in front of us right now.
He's oh,
right
yeah, here. Here he is.
Ooh, that's a bad break there. Rolling that two pin on the bucket. It's going to be an interesting spare here.
Yeah, maybe I'll cover it. Let's see if we can get something here on this. I don't know how well this is going to transpire here over. Let's take a look here.
We have the conventional 4-5-8 leave here.
Yeah, here we go. 4-5-8 for Vince Biondo. Just the 4-5-8. There's Dave Barris. Get out of the way. Please move your head, Dave Barris. That's Dave Barris's head right there. Looks like he got a decent haircut recently.
Yeah, absolutely. Looks like clean and cut.
Here we go.
He's got a chance.
Oh. He's got it.
Well
Vince
done.
Biondo, look at the fist pump.
Yeah, that's right.
I think well I might done. Fist pump something like that, too.
Well done.
Down here, that was worth covering.
Yeah, absolutely.
Checking on the scores down here. Nothing flashy going on down here. I'll take you back down here, Tony Manna. By the way, that strike that you just saw Duffield, or that shot you threw that you saw Duffield, he actually did fall back for a strike there. How's Jennifer today? Yeah? Good.
Oh, we got Jake Bedard rolling the 6-7, or the 6-10 there. Mike's talking to the tournament staff here at Maple Lanes.
Our subscriber growth here, we're at 8204, we appreciate that. I was going to check and see what time the Masters is on today.
It's in Pacific time, so I didn't know how that would transfer here to Central time zone.
Yeah, I got to tell you, I don't ever know what day of the week it is, and I sure as hell don't know what time zone I'm in.
Yeah, because you seem to travel from West Coast to East Coast all over the place.
Yeah, I just don't know anymore. Oh, it looks like the Masters is on now.
Oh, okay.
Just came on 7 minutes ago.
Okay.
I see Mike Anderson from Logo Infusion on there. You're going to learn today. I'll watch it up here in the booth.
What do you think of the younger generation here on tour right now?
You know what? I've got a lot to say. I've actually have a lot to say about that.
Okay.
Yeah, I do. I have a lot to say about that.
I had heard you made the comment yesterday where you thought the all events winner at USBC Nationals this year was going to be under 26.
Yeah.
So I didn't know what your thoughts
were. I like
were
that
on
bet
the,
a lot.
Your thoughts were on how the generation is going now. Because it seems like every time I watch a show nowadays, it seems like they're just getting younger and younger.
They most certainly are. Yeah, no question they are. Hell, I've done this a few times, huh? Okay, so here's something with the PBA Tour right now that I believe is missing. And this is no slam by any means, and this is like I love the work they're doing, and they've really rebounded nicely, the PBA. I'm really happy for them. I got a lot of friends that work over there. So the thing that's missing in history right now with the PBA Tour is this is what I'd like for you to do for me. I'd like for you, off the top of your head, to tell me a list of players that have between 2 and 9 titles.
Okay.
Between the ages of 25 and 39.
25 and 39. Okay. So we have, well, Simonson's too young.
Yep.
Let's see who we got here. That would be right around me. So Josh Blanchard doesn't have any. John Serbinski doesn't. Or Josh has one, I think. Serbinski doesn't have any.
I think Josh has two, but they two? Okay. But they weren't. I'm not taking anything away from Josh Blanchard,
nope,
but they weren't. He hasn't won on ESPN.
Okay.
I guess.
No, that's fine. Yeah, Josh's most notable moment, unfortunately, was the fall.
Yeah, right.
We've all taken it. Just didn't happen on ESPN.
Right.
So.
Right.
That's a tough question there, Mike.
Yeah. So the answer here is Dom Barrett, Bill O'Neill.
Okay.
But here's the problem. There's not a lot.
Right.
Okay. And back when the heyday of bowling, so to speak, I guess is what you would call it.
Mm-hmm. ABC on Saturday afternoons.
There were guys that would make the show.
Mm-hmm.
That fit that demographic that I just talked about. And when they made the show, you were like, oh, he's going to be tough today. Like, just stay rook.
Okay.
Okay, I'm just throwing out a name.
Yep. Okay.
There were a slew of them. Tim Criss. You know, just different guys that had this between age 25 and 39 with 3 to 9 titles. They're not Hall of Fame, but they're like veteran crafty players that they've been on TV before. They've won multiple times. They're a little matured. They've been on tour for a few years. And if they make the show, they're not going to roll over. And you know it's going to be a good match.
Right.
A few weeks ago with the youth movement, you saw A.J. Chapman,
yep.
Who I love A.J. Chapman.
Yeah, he lives, an hour from
he's
here.
He's bowling so. Connor Pickford in the first match. And no offense to either one of these guys. Great young players. But they could have both shot 150. And I don't mean that with disrespect. I just mean that they're not. They don't have between 3 and 9 titles. They're not a little more mature from age 25 to 39.
Yep.
So you had two of these youngsters. Okay. And back in the day, you'd have like a youngster make the show. Oh, Rick Steelsmith made the show. Wichita State grad. Right. You know, like, and that's great. You need young and youth movement, right? But
yep.
I feel like because they're missing these crafty veterans, or some of them have just gotten jobs or gone away from it, that to me, it lessens my viewing interest.
Okay.
Because there aren't these crafty veterans that, you know, it's going to be a hell of a show. And
right.
And it's going to be down to the wire every match. You're going to get good matches. You're going to get good shot making. You know, you got guys in recent years, I can name probably 5 or 6 telecasts where it's like their first show and they're just throwing it out of the back of the building.
Yep.
And they don't even have a chance.
No.
You know what I mean? And they're bowling Belmo.
Yeah.
You know, like, seriously. You know, like, and that's no, they got there. They earned their way to the show and they got to get in their stripes. But right now is a rebuilding time frame for the tour, I think. Like, all these young guys. I think in about 5 years, all those guys fit that demographic I just talked about. If the youth movement keeps coming in and they keep putting in youth players, the tour is going to be the greatest it's ever been in 5 years.
I agree. I totally agree. I think it's going to be, especially like a lot of these guys are, it'll be awfully interesting because of the college situation nowadays where there's so many schools and so many tournaments to bowl. All these guys either bowl together on the same team or against each other all, you know, all year. So now when you start making shows, we'll have storylines, you know, competitive stuff. I think it'll be more entertaining telecast. And I'm hoping for more live telecast. It's
like
been great.
Like, think about this right now, okay? Wesley Lowe, Cameron Doyle, Greg Young, and I'm sure I'm missing other guys. Kyle Sherman.
Yep.
These are the guys that are going to be the next. Marshall Kent also I would put in this category.
Marshall Kent's probably the most talented of the group. He can do stuff in the air that nobody else can.
But
it's just crazy.
But those are your next Simonsons.
Yep.
Francois Lavoie. You know, he kind of jumped them all.
Oh, absolutely. I think he got a lot of international experience, which helped his confidence when he got to the tour. To help kind of accelerate him past a lot of those guys.
There's a kid out of Canada, and I'm drawing a blank.
The lefty? Is it?
No, he's right-handed. He's two-handed. Zach Wilkins.
Okay.
That kid's really good. So what's going to happen in 3 or 4 years when, like, you know, Connor Pickford, A.J. Chapman, these Tang guys, and, I mean, just a whole slew of youth. Anthony Simonson's 25 years old, 26 years old, whatever it is. And, you know, what
Simonson
is,
just turned 20, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what is, what's the tour going to look like then with youth players, where maybe a Spencer Robars makes his first telecast,
right,
and he's got a bowl. You know, at that point in time, the crafty veteran Anthony Simonson, you know, you know, that I'm kind of looking forward to that because there's this gap, there's this generation gap. It's just a huge hole. It's just a huge gap. And you know, you're seeing less and less of the senior players.
Yep.
You know,
because we have
it was just a couple years ago. Parker Bone was, you know, winning a major, and you know, Pete Weber almost won Player of the Year. He's runner up to Belmo. You know, there's Hess down there. He's
only got 180 off the sheet. But
right, but he knows he can still bowl a big game. Last game,
Shea got a little unlucky in his first ball for 210 there. So Shea's going to need a big one, the last one, to get in as well. Josh Luce can strike here for 260.
And I'm sure my point on the PBA could be argued that, oh, no, you're all wrong. You know, you don't need that, blah, blah, blah. But for me, just my own personal opinion, like, I liked it when, like, I'm bringing up another lefty, but, like, John Mazza made the show. Just these guys
right. That,
I mean, there was a slew of them. Like, I almost need to go look right now. PBA bowling title list. Let's see. I want to see this. All-time PBA Tour titles. All right. Let's go with... All right, here we go. Dave Ferraro, 9 titles. John Mazza, 8 titles. Bill O'Neill fits
so
that
he's got
now.
Eight. Yeah, he's got 8. Yeah, okay.
Mike Scroggins. John Mazza comes up. Let's see.
Man, Steve Jarvis only had 7 national titles, but it just seemed like he was always on the show.
Steve Jarvis, that's another guy.
Yeah.
Robert Smith, Mark Williams, Dave DeAntremont, Ron Palumbi, Butch Soper, Jess Stayrook, Ricky Ward, Chris Warren, Roger Bowker, George Branham III, Tim Chris. A lot of these names I mentioned. Eric Forkel. Michael Haugen is still out there, but he's 50 now.
Yep.
Bob Lern, that was another guy. You know what I mean? If Lern made the show, you were in trouble. But he's only got 5 national titles. A guy like Oscar Palermo, where did he go?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's the big two-handed movement, and he kind of got shuffled out.
He's the type of guy that should make it. You know what I mean?
Exactly. I mean, Jesper Svensson now, the lefty.
You know, Scott Devers was bowling back then, Dennis Horan Jr. A lot of these are lefty guys. Rhino Page, another great example of a guy, you know, when he makes the show, he fits that demographic.
Exactly, yep.
Where are these guys?
What about Ronnie Russell? He seems to be tough he's at 3, right?
Yeah, he fits that demographic. Actually, I think he's got more than 3, doesn't he?
I just saw him.
Where is he? Ronnie Russell. There he is. He's got 4.
4, okay.
Yeah, he fits that demographic. So, you know, I want to see more of those guys to fill out a telecast. Now, I can't control that, but that's kind of what I'm looking for. All right, here we go. Game 6 underway, getting going right here. We've got the tournament leader. Really, I think the first look at John Marsala. Everybody can take a look at John Marsala here. He is from St. Charles. I have a history with John. I grew up bowling in the St. Louis area. I know John very, very well, and I'm really happy to see him bowling well. I talked to him yesterday for a little bit, and we discussed this tournament, and he says, Mike, I had to come up and bowl this thing. He goes, nobody in St. Louis, not nobody, but most people don't want to bowl on anything hard, so they can't have an event like this in St. Louis. And with the IV Open moving away, and John just, he's been wanting to come up and bowl this event. John had an event where he, at USBC's, where he bowled over 2,000 a few years ago. So John is a major player and keeps the ball in play. And this is his first time bowling this event. And he came up, said, I wanted to go 100 over. 100 over I thought would be great. He said, I can't believe I led. And John's feeling real good about this event. And I guarantee you, if John were to be able to make it to the title match, which right now he has a commanding lead, and is the top seed, he's going to bowl a hell of a game. And if he wins this, it's going to mean a lot to him.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's going to mean a whole lot to him.
Just knowing, just bowling in our, when I got the chance to go to, you know, be in St. Charles and go to school and bowl in the Major City League, you know, John's one of those nice guys in the league that's always friendly and talks to you and has a good time. And it's good to see guys like that, you know, have success here when they want to challenge themselves and bowl on, you know, the tougher condition here. Do you think it's helped John this weekend being able to keep his angles a little tighter, a little straighter?
Oh,
rather
yeah.
Rather than some of the college kids want to try to bend it a lot of
oh,
lot
absolutely,
of times.
Yeah. Yeah, and John's got this weird pin carry. When his ball goes through the pins, you think it's going to hit real flat, but he sends the pins left to right off the walls, and they fall. And sometimes, like, he'll do these can openers mm-hmm. where it doesn't look like it has no business striking, but it does. So, yeah, so we've got John Marsala. We've got Jacob Borish. We've got Brandon Biondo and Pedro Duderick right here for you, right in front of you. These are your leaders coming in today. I'll tell you where all of them sit through 4 games. John Marsala, your leader at plus 330. Jacob Borish is in second at plus 252. Brandon Biondo is at plus 219 in fourth. His father's gone around him, Vince Biondo. He's in third. And who am I missing on that pair? What do I got? Where was I? Marsala. Sorry, got distracted. Pero Duderick.
Yeah, Pero.
Where did he go? Am I just missing his name here? Wow.
Wow.
He's falling all the way down to 35th today. Came in on the leaders pair. Now he's only 46 over.
So basically him and Mike Peters have switched spots.
Yep. Yep. So we start talking about John Marsala, and then he misses the head pin. He probably knows it. He knows he's on a live stream pair.
Yeah, you got that black cloud thing going again.
I got to tell you, I didn't really think about this much until last night, but because I was on the live stream pair, it is a little nerve-wracking bowling on a live stream pair. I didn't even think about it. You know, I sit up here in the booth, think it's no big deal, but
right. It definitely piques your interest a little bit more when you got that camera behind you. Can't be whiffing the head pin or missing five pins or anything because you know,
picking your nose, grabbing your butt.
We haven't any of that. Senior carry, yeah, we talk about that a little bit here in Waterloo. It's definitely some of the my dad's generation now getting up there a little bit, unfortunately, but they enjoy the awkward carry from time to time. There's no doubt about that.
You know, we were talking about ball companies still a little while ago and everything, and I'm watching this Masters show here up in the booth, and, you know, all Storm and Roto Grip made the show today.
Yep.
Okay. But Evanite International sends the vice president of marketing to go to this event and support the event, mm-hmm. and he's got his wife Gretchen there, Jim Cormier and his wife Gretchen, and guess what? They're sitting right there in the front row cheering on the players. That's a class move right
absolute,
there.
Yeah, that's absolutely.
You could just not go.
No, yeah.
You don't have any representatives on the show, but you still go and support.
I think that's just what bowling needs. It's just more support from, you know, there's a lot of times where people just want to bash bowling or bash what's going on as fast as they possibly can when they should just try to be able to, you know. Constructive criticism is great, but we should all work together to be able to, you know, improve the game, improve the show so we can have more live shows and, you know, have a, you know, whether it's on Wednesday night on ESPN or something, I feel like we need to try to figure out a way to where we can get bowling back to what, you know, we might not be able to get fully back, but we should be able to get, you know, the prize funds up to where we have more interest in bowling and people want to compete.
Yeah, it's going to be the Battle of the Tang Brothers coming up in the next match, it looks like.
So does the dad cheer for one, the mom cheer for the other?
Boy, I don't know.
You hope they both shoot 300 and
just imagine being kids going to the bowling alley and they bowl against each other. I'm sure they've done it. I'm sure they've said, here we are, we're bowling for a PBA major, you and me, this game, let's go.
Right.
Let's go. And today they're actually getting to do it. I mean, it's not a title match, but
that's
insane. It'll be interesting to see how they interact with one another on TV. I think if I bowled my brother on TV, I think I'd just be hooping it up with him.
Oh, I would try to legit try to just keep rubbing it in his face every time I struck, or, you know, if I tripped a four pin, I'd let him know about it. There's no doubt about that.
I wonder if they slept on bunk beds.
Huh? Well, looks like he's talking to somebody having a good time. Is that his mom? What is that? That looks like, looks like Michael will be throwing urethane. It'll be interesting to see what the other brother does.
Yeah, Darren, we'll see.
Because it's one of those things, you bolt together for so long, you know what you need to do to kind of affect the other.
Yep.
You know how that kind of the little head games kind of, you know. That the behind-the-scenes information.
We'll have standings here shortly, I guess.
Sorry, I should have put that back.
No, all good, brother. All all good in the hood. Let's see, where are we at? We'll go here. One of these days I'm going to bring like three monitors, but it's just hard to travel with it.
I don't blame you at all. I got two at work to be able to flip stuff back and forth. But yeah, I couldn't imagine with all the stuff you travel with to be able to get that all in the car.
Dana says, Dick Weber set the example of supporting all bowlers. Boy, I agree with that 100%. Even applauding Walter Ray Williams Jr. when he was beating Pete, but agreed, class act EBI being there. Yeah, the kid Mosley, who is 16 years old, finished tied for 13th place at the Masters, and that's amazing. Yes,
that was
it
a birthday present. Is that what I saw? It was his parents' birthday, or for his birthday, he wanted an entry into the Masters.
Yep.
Was able to parlay that into a 13th place finish. So.
Yeah, really cool story.
It'd be really interesting because, Mike. So Mike Peters just shot, he was in 10th and shot 240. We talked about that a little bit earlier to get to 200 over. He was struggling through four frames, and he's got a couple good breaks to catch a double here in the middle right in front of us to try to hang in there.
Thanks for all the likes. Thanks for watching, everybody. We know you're probably watching Double Vision Bowling right now.
As we hope. Please support the live telecast. We love watching live bowling, so please watch both. Well, it looks like Rosie just dropped off a standing sheet, so let's see if we have one updated here.
There yep.
We are. All right.
So John Marsala leads at plus 319. Jacob Borish is in second at plus 286. Vince Biondo third at plus 270. Fourth, Brandon Biondo at 253. 40-pin difference between fourth and fifth. Dave Barris at 213. Mike Peters at 203 is sixth. Lenny Borish is seventh at 201. Matt Tomsu is eighth at plus 192. Ninth is Tony Manna at 178. Tenth is Jonathan Shallow at 177. Kenny Calkins is at 175, just two pins behind. Then it drops off to Shannon Buchan at 149. So somebody would need a big game to get in there.
Oh. Talking to the parents I see right there on the ESPN stream.
Yeah, who you're rooting for. So Marsala needs to be careful here.
It doesn't look like Jacob has anything going to really give him any concern.
That's
currently.
True.
It doesn't look like... So Calkins has, with a spare here, we'll have... Oh... Just went back-to-back nine whiffs from Kenny Calkins, who is just outside of the number. That will not help the cause. So Mike Peters, after looking like he has nothing through four frames.
Throws a triple.
Gets a couple breaks and then makes a good shot to parlay that into a triple. Can make a run. So we have Shannon, Kenny. So Kenny needs basically the rest, probably. Well, maybe not the rest, but he needs to get it going and stop missing these easy spares. So Jonathan's out on the, he is on the last, 29-30. Looks like, just got a messenger 10 pin to strike there from the distance, I can see.
Do you want to go rogue?
I can.
Hold on. I'll get you set up. You can report scores back.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially this, if we have some guys making some deep runs from down yonder, so. light 7.
There you go. I'll get you set up. All right. So just one of those is going to work. It's a mono channel. One side you'll be able to hear the broadcast. So just put them in. You'll know pretty quickly which side works. Okay. So the other one you don't really have to have in. You can just pop it out if you want. And then your microphone will be that one if you want to do a mic check.
Testing 1, 2.
There you go.
Pretty good.
Yeah, so you can just go wherever you want.
Sounds good. I'll head to the high end.
Maybe if you could grab a standing sheet from the desk, I'll write on it, and we'll see if we can figure out a cut score.
All right, sounds great.
All right, this is going to be great. Normally, I'm the one roaming. I get to sit in the booth this time.
Absolutely. Take you.
This is great. You
can take a load off there. So.
Yeah, isn't it fun? You can just go out, and you can roam, and be wherever you want to be, Nate.
Absolutely.
Perfect.
All right, let's see how we can do
all this. Yeah, it's just,
is that the right one?
Yep, I got
five,
it.
Right?
Yep, got it. So, Marsala and Borish and Biondo. I'm going to go ahead and call in. What's Dave Barris doing? I just want to make sure that he hasn't bowled him. He's not having a disastrous game. Okay. I want to try to see who we got for sure in.
All right. Yeah, he's right here on 15 and 16, right? Do you remember what letter he was?
I can get that for you. I'll have that for you in just one. He is letter B. So he'll be on the left lane, second bowler.
So he has 79 off the sheet. He had front four, 9 spare, and a strike in the 6th.
So he was at plus 213. So I'm going to put him in. Okay, Mike Peters is right in front of us, and he's got a possible 225 left as a max score. Lenny Borish is next on the list. He's in 7th. I'm not sure where Lenny is.
Lenny's right here on 15 and 16 as well.
All right, so what do you got for Lenny? What do you see for Lenny?
He was C, right?
Lenny Borish is letter D. So he will be on the right lane, letter D.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm mistaken what Bears was. Bears has 9 spare. Let's see here. Hold on. He's throwing a shot right now. They struck, so he has a possible... He has a possible 248 left, not 2. I think Lenny is the one that has the... 279 possibility.
Oh, he does?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to pencil Lenny in because he's at 201 right now.
Okay.
Mike Peters is down here. He can bowl 225. He's up in the 9th. I'm actually going to... Well, I just missed his shot. Let's see. He's playing way fall back. He just got a 9 count, so he can shoot 210. Peters can. So Matt Tomsu is next on my list. He's an 8th.
So he will be down here with Brett Cooper and Dave on 21 and 22. Let me wander that way.
All right. And Tomsu is looking for a letter here. Letter B. Yep. He'll be on the left lane.
Yep. He also has 79 off the sheet. Front four, 9 spare, strike in the 6th.
All right, so he was at 192, so I'm going to pencil him in as well. Mike Peters should be in as well. So now we're looking at 9th and 10th. So now we're down to Tony Manna and Jonathan Shallow.
All right, so Jonathan Shallow is down here on 29 and 30, right?
Yeah.
Head down that way.
All right, and be careful with the mic. It'll maybe only go so far.
Okay. Still have me, Mike?
Yep.
Okay.
Gotcha.
All right. So Jonathan Shallow just left the 3610 on 31 and 32. So with a spare, he will have 214 left. He's in the 9th currently.
Okay. 214 max?
Yep.
All right. And then Manna's bowling with Hess and those guys.
Okay.
Like around 19 and 20.
Yep. Shallow did spare in the ninth.
Okay. Man is letter A on the left lane on Hess's pair.
Okay. So it looks like Tony will have 259 max. He's stepping up to bowl in the eighth currently.
Okay. And then I'll need a Kenny Calkins, the third.
He was right in front of you. Well, maybe he's bowling with Marsala, right? He was bowling with Borish and Barris. Kenny will have
letter C.
16 left. 216 max.
Okay, so he's got a 216 max left, and two pins ahead of him is Jonathan Shallow, who has 214 max score left. So if both would go off the sheet, they would tie. And then the other players that we need to know about is Shannon Buchan, if he's bowling a big game. Nathan Mikulowski, if he's bowling a big game. Joseph Grondin, if he's bowling a big game. Kyle Kroll and Tom Hess. Right, and Shea, I guess.
Shea is no good. Shea has 217 max.
Okay. Hess?
Hess has 17 max.
All right. So that ain't going to get there. Kyle Kroll, Joseph Grondin, Nathan Mikulowski, and Shannon Buchan.
Shannon will have 238 max.
Okay. Do we have a score from Shallow yet?
He's stepping up in the 10th currently.
Mike Peters is done at plus 207.
Okay. I'm sorry, Shannon has 248 left, not 238, 248.
248, okay.
Nick, was it Kroll? Was
it? Yep, Kyle Kroll.
Kyle Kroll has...
He's letter D.
Yep. Has 225 max.
Okay, that won't be enough. That will not be enough. Grondin should be on the pair just to the left, letter C.
Yep. He just four pinned and will have 215 max.
Okay, so he isn't going to make it. And then Mikulowski is... He's on Mike Peters' pair. He's letter D, so I can handle that. 213, okay. That ain't going to be enough.
Okay.
All right.
I'm going to go down and see what Shallow's doing here.
All right, perfect. And just keep your eyes open. If anybody's got like a huge game, we need to know who it might be. If you look around, if you see like a giant score somewhere.
Shallow just doubled in the 10th.
Okay.
So he will have in the two teens.
214 is that max, right?
Yep.
Do you see any really big games anywhere? See any big strings like 240s, 250s?
Well, Matt Tomsu does have 279 max. He's stepping up in the ninth currently, but he's currently
he's
in
he's
the number.
In, yeah, he's yep. an eighth. So I'm thinking like Troy Fuller, Josh Luce, Eric Schott, Darren Galbraith, Matt Payne, Jay Watts, Travis Anderson.
Galbraith and them should be on your end.
Okay.
I don't see them down here.
Well, there's no big scores down okay. here at all. Nothing.
Yeah, I got nothing down here.
Okay.
Ooh, Shallow did finish with 214.
214, so Shallow finishes at plus 191. That means Calkins has to go sheet for 216 to okay. tie.
Shannon is stepping up in the 10th currently.
Okay.
248 max.
He sits at 149 right now, so he can get to 197.
Does that pass Shallow? Sorry, I missed that.
Yep, Shallow's at 191.
Okay, so he does need a double to pass Shallow.
Yep.
Good shot. Strike the first one.
All right. So he's in the 220s. Or 230s, I should say.
230, yep.
I think Shannon Buchan's going to make it.
It's one of those things. He does have the nickname of the Bulldog, so when he gets in these tough spots, he seems to perform a little bit. So.
Yeah, he needs that second hit. What's Manna doing? Still striking. Sorry, Tony Manna, is he still doing good down there?
Tony Manna.
He had 259 max score last time you reported through eight.
That's correct. He nine spared in the ninth, so he will have 239 max.
Okay.
Shannon got the second one in the tenth.
He did. So Shannon Buchan is going to make this cut, barring a foul or something like that.
Yep.
And he was in 12th, so he's putting Kenny Calkins the third and Jonathan Shallow on the rope. Shallow in right now in the clubhouse at 191 over. He was in 10th. It looks like Shannon Buchan's going to jump him, and Shannon Buchan's going to grab the 10th spot with Tony Manna bowling a big game in 9th, Matt Tomsu bowling a big game in 8th, Lenny Borish bowling a big game in 7th, Mike Peters in the clubhouse at 207. Dave Barris making it through. Biondo, Borish, and Marsala all making
Shannon
it in.
Shannon did strike out for 248.
248, so that's going to move him to plus 197. Plus 197 for Shannon. So Shannon's going to grab the 10th spot, according to my calculations. Shallow striking out for 214 is not going to be enough. He'll be 11th. And Kenny Calkins, what did he shoot?
Tony just 710 in the first shot in the 10th.
So what can he bowl?
Pocket 710. So this will be, if he gets a 1, it'll be 216.
Oh, my gosh. All right.
So he's just going to be just ahead.
He'll be just ahead of Shallow.
Yep.
Wow. 710 in the 10th.
Even with a miss here, he's got 215, which would keep him ahead.
So Buchan's going to go to 9th.
Yep.
At 197. He's plus 197. What did Manna finish with?
You missed it. 215.
Sorry, okay. 215 he finishes at. So that's 193. So Tony Manna at plus 193. Shannon Buchan's at plus 197. Shallow's at 191. What did Tomsu finish with?
Stepping up in the 10th right now, and he has 258 max.
Okay, so he's definitely in. Marsala down here is going to be your leader. Jacob Borish is going to be second.
Looks like Calkins just finished with 205.
Calkins finished with 205. That's plus 180. He's not going to make it. Shallow's not going to make it. So Marsala, Jacob Borish, Vince Biondo, Brandon Biondo, Dave Barris, Mike Peters, Lenny Borish, Matt Tomsu, Shannon Buchan, and Tony Manna are going to be your top 10. Barring nobody bowling 270 or higher from 18th to 23rd position, but we don't see any 270s anywhere in the building, right?
69, but it was from Roger Taylor Jr. Roger. Who was in 52nd.
Yep. Okay. That's gonna do it.
Tomsu is going to, with a spare, will shoot 248.
Do we know what Dave Barris bowled? It's not all that important. Oh, he's still bowling right now. He's where is he? He's on 15 and 16.
He should be bowling with Lenny Borish, right?
Yep.
Well, he should be finished.
See if you can get a final score for Barris.
13, right? 213.
Is that what he had?
I believe so, right? He was letter B?
Yep, letter B, yep. 213. So he gets to 226. What's Borish got left?
237 with a strike here. He's throwing his field ball currently.
So he'll go ahead of Barris. And did you get a final score for Tom Sue?
248. Borish did strike for 237.
So he's plus 238. And you said it was 248 for Tom Sue?
Correct.
So that puts him at plus 240. So Tom Sue jumps the fifth. Borish will be sixth. Barris will be seventh. Mike Peters will be eighth. Shannon Buchan will be ninth, and Tony Mano will be tenth. Ninth for Buchan. Tom Sue will be fifth. Fourth will be Borish. I'm sorry, sixth will be Borish. Seventh will be Barris.
We do have an update on the ESPN match as well.
Yeah.
They're basically even through six. Well, I apologize. Even through five. Darren Tang is stepping up in the sixth. If he strikes here, he'll be down two pins. Both throwing urethane up the gutter. And he got nine, so he'll be down 12 through six.
Okay, well, Nate, I'm going to end the broadcast now because we need to get the camera set up. So
I'll head your way.
One more time, John Marsala, Jacob Borish, Vince Biondo, Brandon Biondo, Matt Tom Sue, Lenny Borish, Dave Barris, Mike Peters, Shannon Buchan, and Tony Mana, unofficially, according to our numbers, are your top 10. So Tony Mana will bowl Dave Barris, and Shannon Buchan will bowl Mike Peters when we come back.